Good day to you, all of you. It is my pleasure to welcome you all to this session on the clinical management of dengue for adults and children. We are doing this mainly targeting the medical officers and other healthcare staff in Eastern Province, anticipating an dengue outbreak with upcoming monsoons. I think that this is the very good time to update our knowledge on the clinical management, because that we know that almost 2 years now that we are struggling with COVID-19. Most of our energy and time has been dedicated to COVID-19 management and preventive activities, but this is the high time to focus on dengue also. Otherwise, what will happen is when the COVID-19 going down, there will be a coming up the dengue in a epidemic proportion. So because of that, I think that all of you will take the maximum utilization of this session, though that we are doing this on a virtual platform. I think that many knowledge can be gathered and update our knowledge. So I invite all of you to join this very proactively and actively and gain the knowledge. So we will be able to better manage the dengue patients and minimizing the deaths and complications. Now I hand this over to my colleagues here to proceed with.
Thank you, sir, Director, National Dengue Control Unit. May I now invite our first resource person, Dr. K.T. Sundaresan from Teaching Hospital Batik Flow to proceed with the presentation. So over to you.
Let me share the screen.
Yes.
Well, so I can share it,
when, yes, so. Yes.
Can see, no?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Sir, yes, yes. You can go in across the presentation mode.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you very much, the director and Dr. Lahiru. I think this is a very important topic. Again, I'm sure we are going to face another another dengue crisis. I mean, we are going to face very soon. So I think this is the right time to discuss about dengue management. I'm sure there will be overlap between my talk and the Dr. Arshad talk. He will be talking on the pediatric children management. Of course, I will be talking on adult, but basically both are same. Right. So if you see, I think I must first of all thank a few people, but particularly I have learned lot about the management of dengue from many people, especially Dr. Lakumar. So some of the slides are from him. So at the onset, I would like to thank him. So if you see the death, once upon a time, the Sri Lanka, the death rate of dengue hemorrhagic fever is about 9.8 in 1989. Then 1% in 2009. And 2012, it's 0.4%. 2018, it's 0.11%. This is again from Dr. Lakumar. I think, it's really we are doing a good job. I think within few years, our death mortality has reduced 10 times. There's a reduction in the mortality. But if you compare 1989 figures, about 100-fold reduction. See, I'm going to talk in English. There may be Tamil-speaking people, there may be Sinhala-speaking people, and there are doctors and nurses. Anybody can interfere me, so no problem at all. And you can ask question now at the end in whatever the language, English, Sinhala, or Tamil. Right, so if you see, it was very high, the mortality, then slowly came down. Now we are in a really good position. I think in South Asia, even in the world, I think we are one of the best country managing the dengue very well. But I think there are further, we can improve further after seeing COVID infection and its management. There are similarity between the dengue and the COVID. And already we are managing the complication, that is leakage. Simply we are just treating the leakage. But after seeing the COVID, I believe, I'm sure in the future, we will be having better treatment option even to suppress the inflammation or the immunity, which we never did it. If you see the cause of death, now why we have to talk, because if you see the cause of death, nearly about 50% of the deaths are due to obvious hypovolemia, shock and death. Then another nearly 50% are due to fluid overload, that is by us. So at least half of this thing could have been prevented by giving the right amount of fluid. If you see the differences, what is dengue fever and dengue hemorrhagic fever? Today our talk is going to be on dengue hemorrhagic fever. So the basic difference is plasma leakage. Dengue fever will not leak. Dengue hemorrhagic fever will leak. But it's very difficult in the beginning to tell this is dengue fever, this is dengue hemorrhagic fever. Only when discharge or after some time only you will know, yes, this is dengue fever because there's no leakage. So the difference between dengue fever and dengue hemorrhagic fever is leakage. Whether you know it or not doesn't matter, but whenever leak, what to do is the most important thing. Dengue fever also, even though there is no leakage, they can bleed. Even significant bleeding can occur. Simple purpura, ecchymosis, bleeding in the gum, nasal bleeding, even hematuria, hematemesis, all this can happen with dengue fever. So whatever you do with dengue fever, they will survive. So that won't kill. Dengue fever will not kill us. If you look at this one, see, if there are 10,000 patients, nearly 9,000 is asymptomatic, right? Only 1,000 will be symptomatic. Then in that 1,000, if you see, only 100 will leak. Others is the dengue fever. I don't know. So forget about this. So only 100 out of 1,000, only 100 will leak. Even in that 100, only 1 to 2% will have shock. So when you have one shock, that means already there are nearly 10,000 people in the community. Some are asymptomatic, some are symptomatic. This is the basic things you all should know. We look what the first part, you know, the incubation period is about 5 days. It may go a little more than that. The febrile phase, there are three phases, febrile phase, critical phase, and the recovery phase. So you can forget everything, but if you know how to manage this critical, that's it we want. So febrile phase is about it. Imagine like this. These like first 5 days, febrile phase, then 2 days, critical phase, last 5 days, recovery, roughly. I'm telling roughly. So 5 days, 2 days, 5 days. 5 days before this incubation period, no symptom at all. There's a bite by the mosquito, but no symptom. That is 5 days. So 5 days, 5 days, 2 days, 5 days, roughly. So first 5 days, just like any other fever, body ache, myalgia, headache, and pain behind the eye, retroorbital pain, that kind of thing can happen. Sometimes people have loose motion, just like in COVID. So this is just like a fever, febrile phase. Then you have the second phase where you have leakage. That's the most important part. Maximum it can last up to 48 hours, sometimes few hours. So usually it is nearly 48 hours leakage. Then you have recovery. Now, one of the most important thing is all of us should know, you particularly the parents, when you advise the parents or relative, now first phase, febrile phase, the fever goes up, fever, temperature goes up and comes down. So problem starts when the fever comes down. When there's no fever, problem starts. So people may find, they may feel better, they may think everything has gone. So particularly we have to warn the relatives or parents that when the fever settles, don't think that you have recovered. So when the fever settles, problem starts. So February 5th, nothing can happen. Maybe dehydration, you can hydrate them well, but this is the time you have leakage. Another important thing is platelet is dropping. It usually in the February slowly dropping, and but there may be dramatic drop in the platelet during the critical phase. Hematocrit, higher the hematocrit, higher the leakage. So higher the hematocrit, higher the leakage. So when there's a leakage, hematocrit goes up. You should understand this also. Just like COVID, initial 5 days, you have viruses. You have virus in the blood in your initial first phase. So virus is there in the first 5 days. After that, no virus. It's a, just like COVID, it's an inflammatory phase. We can say critical and recovery phase. First 5 days, you have viremia. This is also very important to understand. Again, the same thing. See, this is the mosquito bite, say roughly about 5 days, no symptom. That is the incubation period. Then the virus goes up, then comes down. So these days, the first next 5 days is the viral phase or febrile phase. Then you have the critical phase for about 48 hours, then recover. So understand, during this phase only virus is there. So you can detect NS1 antigen during the first 5 days. Remember, NS1 antigen, first 5 days of illness, you can have NS1 antigen. Then the virus antigen will come down. It may not be detected. Earlier the antigen test, better. After that, you'll have antibody. Dengue, IgM and IgG. IgM, acute infection. IgG, earlier infection. Actually, this NS1 is unlike now, you know, rapid antigen test in COVID. It is for to detect the spike protein. Here, it's not like that. It's not a structural protein. The protein is detect the non-structural protein NS1 in dengue virus. Okay, got it. Again, I'm repeating. First 5 days, you do NS1 antigen. After that, you can do antibodies. If right, these are for mainly doctors in OPD and ETU, when to admit a patient. There are warning signs when there is abdominal pain or tenderness, particularly tender hepatomegaly, means there is leakage, you have to admit. Persistent, any ill patient like persistent vomiting, lethargy, restlessness, mucosal bleeding, evidence of leakage. So any ill patient or any evidence of leakage, admit. And also roughly we say less than 100,000 platelets are better admit because they can leak at any time. When they look ill, admit. Poor home support, poor access to hospital, living alone, or if the individual feels they need to admit, better admit. Pregnancy, elderly people, obesity, all these categories need admission. So again, my talk mainly on the critical phase. Before that, we'll finish the first phase, that is febrile phase, where no leakage have. There's no leakage in the febrile phase. You can give enough fluid, and how much to give, just like any other fever. If they are vomiting and diarrhea, you may have to give IV fluid or Jeevani. So hydrate, probably it's my personal opinion, better hydrate well here, because in the critical phase, we are going to restrict the fluid. Remember that. We are going to restrict. We are not going to give even the normal fluid. So probably I feel you can hydrate well during this febrile phase. And do not give NSAIDs like aspirin or diclofenac sodium or ibuprofen should not be given. Steroid also should not be given. So there were some research, or at least one research in Vietnam, they gave steroid in the initial phase, the mortality increases. But I believe, this is only my belief, if you give here in the critical phase, there's a possibility, there's an improvement. So, but don't, like, I'm not recommending, this is not in the guidelines, so don't give NSAID or steroid for dengue fever or dengue hemorrhagic fever. So now, what is the main concern during the febrile phase? you are just waiting. You are monitoring the patient. You are monitoring the patient to catch the leakage. That's it. Whatever you do February, nothing will happen, but you are going to catch the critical phase as quickly as on time. So you monitor. Because once the critical phase started, you are going to restrict the fluid. So when the platelet is less than 100,000, at any time they can leak. But recently we noticed, last time, we noticed that even 40,000, 50,000, no leakage. So time to time it varies, maybe depending on the serotype and various other factors, maybe they are. But usually for us, better think when the platelet is less than 100,000, look for leakage. So why do we monitor? Basically to catch the critical phase. And we do, depending on the human resources, 4 to 6 hourly, we do monitor. This is the monitor, the chart. Every ward has this one. Every medical or pediatric ward should have this one. So date is their heart rate, blood pressure here, weight is there. And it's every 4 to 6 hourly, we do monitor. Pulse pressure, we'll talk about pulse pressure. And of course, pediatric, they do look mainly the capillary refilling time, whether extremity is warm or cold, but adults, we don't use this much. Respiratory rate is important, urine output, PCV or hematocrit, platelet count, any other remark. This is the chart. I'll give one example here. This is actually, again, I copied from one of the talk from the epidemiology unit. So that's why 7 years. Basically, my talk is about the adult. So if you see here, heart rate is 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Heart rate is throughout good. Blood pressure for this child, okay. Mainly look at the pulse pressure. That is what is more important. It looks normal. As long as 30 or more than 30 is good. And respiratory rate is good. Urine output is good. Urine output, usually this one should be 0.5 to 1. I'll come to that. 0.5 to 1 ml per kilogram per hour. PCV, there's not much of rise. Almost the same. Platelet, there's a drop. So this is basically a dengue fever, right? It's a dengue fever because there is no evidence of leakage. If there's evidence of leakage, the pulse pressure may drop, urine output may drop, that may be later present, later feature, and the PCV should increase, that is most important. The PCV should increase by at least 20% usually to say there is leakage. Here is no leakage, so this is a dengue fever. This one, if you look at this one, 10th, 11th, 12th, again 12th, 9 a.m., 2 p.m. See the heart rate, okay, maybe a little bit high here. Look at the pulse pressure, 40, that's okay, 30, but here 20, it's not good. Pulse pressure dropped. And urine output, okay, that's fine, because it will take long time to urine output to come down, so that's fine. PCV, 35, now 42. If you calculate, it is more than 20% increment. Platelet count drops. So this is dengue hemorrhagic fever. The leakage happens somewhere here between these time. So it's very important to detect the onset of leakage. You will understand very soon why I am. So onset of leakage is important. So this is leakage. Now the patient has entered into critical phase. Now the chart will change. We will show that later. So entry into critical phase. Right. How do we know? There are many ways, you know, there is evidence of plasma leakage. There's many ways, you know, the evidence of plasma leakage. One of the most important thing is hematocrit. So if there's a 20% increase from the baseline, that's suggestive of a very significant leakage. For example, the PC from 35 to 42 leakage. 40 to 48, that's also leakage, that means 20%. 45 to 51, that is 20%. So this is suggestive of leakage. Second thing is those tests we used to do chest X-ray, right lateral decubitus, right side. You turn the patient to the right side and get the chest X-ray. Right lateral decubitus. There you can see, if you do a chest X-ray AP view or PA view, you may not see the effusion, but if you do the chest X-ray right lateral decubitus, you may be able to see. But the best thing now, wherever it's possible, ultrasound scan is the most sensitive test to detect plasma leakage. Again, this is from Dr. Lakumar. There's a transient plasma leakage through the capillary wall, or it's somehow the leakage in dengue hemorrhagic fever occurs in the pleura and peritoneal cavities, right? Currently, ultrasound scan is the most objective way to diagnose dengue hemorrhagic fever in the clinical setting. So the best thing, ultrasound scan. So what I am going to talk hereafter is very, very important. Again, look at HCT 20% increase and chest X-ray right lateral decubitus. Ultrasound scan is the most sensitive way of detecting leakage. After that, ultrasound scan will not be useful. You don't do see whether it is, we may do, but after that you go by HCT. So first detect by the ultrasound scan, then do the serial HCT, hematocrit, and see where we are leading. Once the critical phase starts, this next 48 hours will decide which side the patient is going to. Just like COVID. COVID, whatever you do within that critical time, inflammatory phase, will decide whether it's like a death and life. Here also like that. But in COVID, of course, the death rate is much higher. Here, mostly preventable deaths. Preventable deaths. Why we are talking here, one of the things I have to tell, just by understanding, by proper, right knowledge, will save many lives. Many doctors are here. I'm repeating, we are giving this knowledge because I got this knowledge from other people. I can confidently say we have saved many lives just by the right knowledge. So similarly, I just sharing the knowledge, you use it and save the life. So whatever you do in the next 48 hours, really determine whether which side the patient's going to be. So you must treat properly. Right. Again, I'm repeating, what are the evidence of plasma leakage? Increasing hematocrit, decreasing pulse pressure, pleural effusion, ascites, tender hepatomegaly, because when there is a leakage, that's also very important. When there is a leakage, right it stretches the capsule, liver capsule. So that causes tender hepatomegaly. Decreasing urine output, which is too late. And other two parameters are serum albumin. That also can leak. It will be less than, if it is less than 3.5 gram per deciliter, that suggests plasma leakage. Non-fasting serum cholesterol less than 100 suggests, so cholesterol also leak. Sometimes this problem comes whether you have some free fluid. We don't know whether due to some other infection, some other bacterial infection or dengue, we don't know. Then this may be useful. Now, if you can answer these 4 or 5 questions, then you know how to manage dengue hemorrhagic fever. What are they? Now, next 48 hours, you should know what fluid are you going to give. Number one, how much are you going to give? What rate are you going to give? So what fluid, how much are you going to give? What rate are you going to give? What should not be given, also very, very important. So what fluid are you going to give? How much fluid are you going to do for the next 48 hours? What rate are you going to give fluid and what should not be given? So the simple answer is what fluid, basically about 90% of the time, it is crystalloid. Normal saline, Hartmann. We don't give dextrose. Normal saline, Hartmann. How much? for now Dr. Arshad will talk about pediatric people, then calculation will be very important. For adult people, more than 50 kilograms, whether 50, 60, 70, 80, 100 pregnancy, anybody, it is 4,600 ml for next 48 hours. Again, I'm repeating, 4,600 ml for next 48 hours. That much of fluid. What rate? Again, I'm giving 95% of the time, how much you give is nearly, it is almost always less than 2 ml per kilogram per hour. I'm repeating 2 ml. Most of the time, it's 1.5 ml per kilogram per hour. Or 2 ml, less than 2 ml per kilogram per hour. Then you look, 2 ml per kilogram per hour mean for a 50 kilo person, it's about, it's, it is, if it's 200 ml per hour, remember that, at least if you can forget everything, remember, usually 75, that means 1.5, 75 to 100 ml per hour is most of the time is adequate per hour. So what should not be given? Don't give platelet unnecessarily, very rarely only platelet needed. Blood also most of the time you don't need. FFP, no place. So most of the other things, don't give. So most of the things are not necessary. See, it is timing. Again, we said ultrasound is the most sensitive way to detect the critical phase, but it is not always easy as we think. Sometimes we do mistake, but whatever mistake you do, my personal opinion is, my personal experience is, if you go by this 1.52 rules, less than most of the people, if you don't know where to start, how much fluid to start, start either, if they are looking much better, start maybe 1.5 ml per kilogram per hour. That is about 75 ml per hour for an adult. Then look at the HCT and decide how much to give. Right. Now this is another example. So the detecting the beginning of the critical phase, not easy. Some experts say when there is, now look at the WBC, it comes down, 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 and again goes up. If you look at the platelet, it comes down, down, and suddenly there's a drop. So some says when there's a decreased white cell and sudden rise of white cell, and there's when there's sudden drop, when these two meets, that's the time the plasma leakage started. Practically speaking, it's not that easy as we think. So this is the, if you look at other parameters also, 39, I think it's not really 20%, but because of this sudden drop of platelet and white cell increase, so most likely the plasma, I mean critical phase is these 48 hours. 19, 20th. Platelet comes down and down and down and down, and there's a sudden drop. White cell comes down and goes up. So it says this is a time of beginning of critical. If you don't know this, forget about this. Not practically, I don't. It's difficult. Okay. How much to give? The calculation, I'm sure Dr. Arshad may deal with the calculation. But for the 50 kilo or more than 50 kilo people, you give 4,600 ml for next 48 hours. This is the calculation. You can look into this. Now, if you look at the guideline, the leakage, if you look at the leakage, see, this is the critical phase. Leakage, they say, goes up, 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 then comes down. 1.5 ml, 3 ml leakage. That means fluid, you must give fluid, no, 5 ml, 7 ml. This is, practically, does not happen. So please, don't take this. As I said, I'm sure Dr. Arshad also share his experience. It is most of the time less than 2 ml per kilogram per hour. Very few people made it little more than that. So this graph, I don't believe it is there in every guideline, I believe. So don't follow this. I just mentioned, showed this just to say it is not right. Right. Once you detected the beginning of the critical phase, thereafter it is the hematocrit is very, very important. And so the rate of fluid, as I said, you start 1.52, change goes up and down, go by the hematocrit. For example, hematocrit is, we'll say, 42. After 4 hours, you give 1.5 ml per kilogram per hour. After 4 hours, again, hematocrit is 35. Another scenario, initial hematocrit is 35. After four hours, it went up to 42. Third scenario, initial hematocrit is 35. After 4 hours, it came down to 32. Just imagine these three scenarios. If the hematocrit is 35 and after 4 hours also 35, that means you have given fluid which is equivalent to the leakage. If the hematocrit is 35 and after 4 hours, it went up to 42, we'll say 40, then you have given fluid. The leakage is more than the fluid you have given. If the hematocrit comes down, that means you have given more fluid than the leakage. If you can't understand, just think later. Very simple thing I'm talking. So by repeating the hematocrit, maybe 6 hourly, maybe 4 hourly, you know how whether the fluid you are giving is adequate or not. Another important, this is my rule. I think this is what Dr. Lakuma says, less than 1.5 ml per kilogram per hour. But our patient, it is less than 2 ml per kilogram per hour, right? Again, I told you what fluid. It is crystalloid is the fluid you usually give, normal saline and hardman. And what about colloid? Colloid is, we don't like to give colloid frequently, only in shock or some other rare condition where the colloid is needed. The drug of choice is Dextran 40. I think Hetastach we don't have, I believe. And there was some problem in the past with Hetastach, so we are giving Dextran. Again, even in shock, crystalloid is more than enough. That is a choice. The fluid choice is crystalloid. As a third line only, you go for colloid. Remember, when I say 2 ml per kilogram per hour or 1.5 ml per kilogram per hour, I mean total IV plus oral fluid. IV plus oral fluid. Oral better than water, some kind of jeevani or some kind of electrolyte solution may be better, or soup, that kind of thing. Now, if you give saline or crystalloid, it stays nearly for about 1 hour in the vascular compartment. If you give colloid, it stays little longer, 4 to 6 hours. Then why don't we prefer colloid? I'll come to that. So it's good now. If you give colloid, it stays inside the intravascular compartment for a long time. So that's good, but we don't give. There are some reasons I'll tell. So dramatic immediate benefit you can see with colloid. But some says when you give colloid, it increases the vascular leakage due to increased baseline hydrostatic pressure. So that is one. These are probably a hypothesis. Another disadvantages of colloids are, colloid may leak into the interstitium and can exert a reverse osmotic effect. That means if it goes out of vascular compartment, it attracts more fluid from the intravascular compartment and worsens the shock. Understood? So the colloid can come out of the vascular compartment in the interstitium and exert the osmotic effect. It attracts the fluid from the intravascular compartment, worsen the shock. Second thing is there may be allergic reaction with colloid. Thirdly, it may adversely affect the blood coagulation. So we don't want that to happen with colloid. So these are the reasons why we don't prefer colloid as a first line. Again, I'm telling again same thing, I'm repeating. So as I said, if you are given 1.5 ml per kilogram power, that is about 75 ml power, you can give this one regime, that is 25 ml per hour IV, then 50 ml per hour oral. So oral plus IV together 1.5. Understood? 25 plus 50 ml oral. And you measure the urine output every 4 hours. Another important thing, this is, remember this 1.5. Another thing you have to remember is 0.5 to 1. Urine output should be more than 0.5 ml per hour, ml per kilogram per hour. I had some confusion whether 50, 60, any kilogram, any weight patient, it is same. When he asked the nephrologist and some other people, it says, so 50 or 60, it is, we take as 50. That means you want to have at least 25 ml per hour urine output. For 4 hours, it's about 100. So it should not be less than 100 for 4 hours. Got it? So I'm just repeating again and again. So the urine output should be 0.5 to 1 ml per kilogram per hour. In a simple word, for an adult, it should be more than 25 ml per hour. More than 25 ml per hour. So when you give fluid, as I said in the beginning, actually for the next 48 hours, we are giving fluid somewhere around 2 ml to 1.5 ml per kilogram per hour, depending on the HCT, pulse pressure, and so on. But you have to monitor. There are a few very important things to monitor other than HCT. Pulse pressure. Pulse pressure is very, very important, not blood pressure. Pulse pressure means when you say 120 by 80, the pulse pressure is 120 minus 80, that is 40. If the blood pressure is 100 by 70, 100 minus 70 is 30. 30 is the pulse pressure, the difference between systolic and diastolic pressure. So the pulse pressure, we would like to maintain more than 30 millimeter per hg. If it is between 25 to 30, better you must see whether we are giving enough fluid, and the nurses should inform the relevant people, or the doctor should inform their superiors. So if it is less than 25, I'm talking about pulse pressure less than 25 for half an hour, then you should not delay. There are nurses here, please remember, nurses, please remember, pulse pressure should be more than 30. If it is between 25 to 30 for 30 minutes, inform the doctors. If it is less than 25, definitely inform and intervene. If it is less than 20 or less than 20, bad. You must call immediately. You must call the doctors immediately. If the, it's very common to have, low urine output. I mean, not common, I mean, very frequently we see suddenly everything is okay, pulse is okay, blood pressure is okay, everything is okay, low urine output. So don't panic. Check whether, whether there's full bladder, if necessary, catheterize. If there's a catheter, check whether it's blocked. If you have ultrasound scan, see there is enough urine in the bladder. So most of the time it settles. If as long as there's no tachycardia, pulse pressure is okay, patient looks fine, I don't think you should panic. Check where it's wrong and wait for some time and see whether your urine output is improving. If it's not improved, then we have to take measures. Tachycardia also, you can't ignore. if the pulse rate is more than 100, don't ignore, never ignore. But most of the time, as some people, it's due to fear. They are anxious and there's tachycardia. So better check sleeping heartbeat. Sleeping tachycardia is significant. Fever can cause tachycardia. Bleeding can cause tachycardia. But most importantly here, the leaking, hypovolemia can cause tachycardia. Fluid overload also can cause tachycardia. I am not experienced with this one. Some says hypocalcemia also can cause tachycardia. So what are our target? There should not be tachycardia. And check if there's tachycardia, check what is the reason. Pulse pressure more than 30 millimeters. Urine output 0.5 to 1 ml per kilogram per hour. That is about nearly 75 to 100 ml per hour. FFP, place for other fluid. FFP, no. Most, no. Very rarely when the patient really bad, sometimes we may have to give, but most of the time, no. Platelet, most of the time we don't give, rarely we give. Blood, there are some many controversial things. There are some people tend to give blood little earlier than real indication. So I just leave up to them. But most of the time you don't need blood. Another important thing, again, I'm emphasizing, remember, it's many of us have noticed the severely bad patients, sometime before they become bad, ferritin can go up, lactate can go up. This can be done in bigger hospital only. So if they are ill, too ill, too much of leakage, ill, patients not good, better do SGOT, SGBT, serum ferritin if available, and blood gas and see the lactate. These are really bad if it is very high. Ferritin is it's a prognostic marker. Higher the ferritin, worse the, prognosis, and lactate also, it's not good. Basically, it increases due to liver damage. So I feel SGOT, SGBT, or liver function test should be a routine test. If it is significantly elevated, then you do ferritin and lactate. See, this is the chart we do in critical phase. Anyway, this again, I copied from one of the talks by the epidemiology unit. See, look at some of the important, this is fluid. See, 1.1 ml per kilogram, 1.5, 2, like that. Usually it's not, this is not the typical fluid we are giving this atypical patient, I don't know. See the heart rate, this is not good. 100, 104, these are not good. Pulse pressure, 20, 15, this is not good. When you see this one, this 1.5 is not enough. You have to increase the dose. It was not increased due to some reason. See, 20, 20. And the urine output also, this urine output, 0.4, 0.4, this is not good. So this could have been intervened here, somewhere here. But it went on like that, 20, 20, which is not really good. 15, then here only, somebody has increased the fluid to like shock, 10 ml per kilogram per hour, that's about 500 ml. After that, then slowly decreased. It was a little better. The urine output improved little. Then after that, same graph. So this chart is very, very important. By looking at, we can say the patient is old here. It's too late actually here, even though I think this patient has improved and probably survived. But if you look at the heart rate, this could have been intervened somewhere here. See the pulse pressure 20, 15, 20, this is bad actually. It could have intervened somewhere here. You don't know, it was low. Probably this patient survived, I believe. So same, this thing after that, what happened? The pulse pressure went up well. Urine output improved. Tachycardia. See, this is one of the most important. Tachycardia, if you get 82, we know patient is very comfortable. So this chart is very important. This is the critical phase chart for 48 hours. Platelet transfusion, most of the time, you don't need, unless there's a significant bleeding and very low. Even 10,000 platelet, we do wait. Even sometimes 5,000, we don't give. Because those are very active platelet. They are they can protect you from platelet, but some people do give when it's very low. But usually, low platelet plus bleeding, you give platelet transfusion. Now, shock, same question. When there is shock, what fluid to give, how much, what is the rate, and that kind of thing. And here, hematocrit is very important. Now, okay, there are two types of shock we are discussing here when it comes to dengue shock. One is compensated, mean when the, not pulse, I think blood pressure, or pulse is not, one is BP. BP, you can't measure the BP. That is, you can measure the pulse is palpable and you can measure the BP, that is compensated. That's not bad. Another shock is where BP is not, or pulse is not palpable. You can't feel the pulse. BP is not recordable. So that is kind of decompensated shock. So there are two types of shock. So don't panic again. There is shock. Pulse pressure is less than 20. Urine output is less than 0.5. Tachycardia, restless. What will you give? But you can feel the pulse. Blood pressure is recordable. What will you give? Again, I'm repeating. 10 ml per kilogram power for an adult. 500 ml over 1 hour. I'm repeating. Normal saline. 500 ml over 1 hour. This is the one you have to. Don't panic. You give that. Meanwhile, any ill patient still not improved, what will you give? Go for crystalloid. Again, normal saline, 10 ml per kilogram or 1 hour. If that, usually by this time they will improve, and slowly you can gradually, step by step, you can reduce the fluid. But even if there's no improvement, then you go for colloid boluses. Again, 10 ml per kilogram per hour. So you can give colloid. So you have to do hematocrit before and after the this infusion, after 1 hour. Take hematocrit before giving this saline or colloid, and after finishing and get another hematocrit. I have forgotten, I think we'll ask Dr. Arshad later. May the drop should be, I think, 5, I believe. There should be the hematocrit. Once you give, the hematocrit comes down or drop. If the drop is, for example, we are expecting a drop of 5. We'll say 45 initially, then it should reduce to 40. But if the drop is 35, not 40, 30, then you must think of bleeding. When there is unexpected drop of hematocrit, think about bleeding. Think about bleeding. And meanwhile, there is, you have to think about A, B, C, S. I'll come to that. Here it comes. I'll come to that. You have to check this ABCS. What is this? When the patient is ill, seriously ill, critical condition. A, check for acidosis. Do the blood gas. B, check for bleeding, internal bleeding. C, calcium. Routinely give IV calcium gluconate. Check for sugar. These are very, so check for acidosis, bleeding, calcium, and sugar. Okay, so then you go, then after that, what will you do after shock? If you give 10 ml, then slowly reduce, maybe next fluid maybe 7 or 8 ml per kilogram per hour. Then after 1 or 2 hours, reduce further to maybe 5 or 6. So slowly, if you drop suddenly, again the shock may reappear. Maximum leakage you can expect is, it is said, 10 ml per kilogram per hour. That's the maximum the body can leak, maximum to 10 ml per kilogram per hour. If the blood pressure is not measurable, not palpable, measurable, or pulse is not palpable, then there are two ways. Some give 20 ml per kilogram. That is as fast as possible till you get the blood pressure and pulse, till the BP and pulse can be felt. After that, you can reduce to 10 ml per kilogram bolus. So there are two ways, right? Some says 20 ml, then once you can get the BP and pulse, when it's, you can feel, then you give 10 ml per kilogram boluses Likewise, you give crystalloid. Then that again, third line only colloid. Check the hematocrit before and after IV fluid. ABCS we already discussed. Another important thing is management of fluid overload. Remember, basically, if you give fluid like 1.5 to 2 ml per kilogram power, you can't have fluid overload. You can't overload the patient. So to me, to understanding the beginning of the critical phase may not be that very important. Even without knowing the timing, you can give fluid. If it is between 1.2, you can't overload the patient. So overload is basically, it's our fault. But it's difficult to treat sometimes. Then the leakage. Usually these people are dyspneic or tachypneic. Leakage people, usually they are not dyspneic, but fluid overload, if they are tachypneic, dyspneic, think about fluid overload. It's how do you manage fluid overload? It's difficult. Sometimes there is enough fluid outside the vascular compartment, but intravascular is low. So it's a paradoxical thing. Low volume inside the vessel, outside too much of fluid. So best thing you can do is you give a bolus of colloid. Colloid is osmotically active. It attracts the fluid from outside the vascular compartment. It takes the fluid out to inside the blood vessels. And so it attracts it and it increases the intravascular compartment. Two things at the same time. You take the fluid in and increase the intravascular. So ideal thing, a little bit of colloid plus a little bit of diuretic. Because once it comes in, it has to go out. So a little bit of colloid and a little bit of furosemide may do the job. As I said, when there's unexplainable drop of hematocrit, first of all, you have to make sure hematocrit is right. You may have to repeat it. If it is unexplainable drop of hematocrit, think about bleeding. Think about bleeding. I think that's I have given most important part so far. Now the last part, maybe few slides, one or two slides probably. Convalescent phase. After 48 hours, you will enter into the recovery phase. What have this also very important. Appetite improves. You may get a rash like this, convalescent rash. I think this itchy rash, convalescent rash. They can have pruritus in the palm and the feet, sole. But the mothers or parents may afraid. They may think again another rash. They may think dengue has worsened. So remember, this is a good sign actually. If they get itchy sole and palm, it's good. Bradycardia, they may get bradycardia, diuresis, polyuria, and the white cell may go up, platelet goes down. Dr. Lakma used to say 90% of the time when two consecutive platelet counts rise, leaking has stopped. That means if you see a two platelet count rising trend, then you are in the recovery phase. That's the end of my talk, I believe. Yes. If you have any question, either I can answer now. Or if you have the time, I can spend later. Dr. Lahiru, I have finished my job. If anyone wants to ask question, they can ask now or later.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for the comprehensive presentation. If anyone has questions, you can raise hand and we can allow you to speak.
Ask any language, in Tamil or Sinhala, English doesn't matter. Please ask and clarify, because I learned from some expert, and now here with experience, I have shared few things, learn whatever I can. If I can't answer, Dr. Arshad will answer. Yeah.
You can raise hand and ask questions if you have any questions, and we will be giving you some time at the end of the all presentations as well.
Yeah, if you want any question, I will write my mobile number also. If anyone wants to send WhatsApp or anything, you can write to me if somebody is shy. Okay, this is my number, WhatsApp, and this you can, don't call me, but you can text me or message me through WhatsApp. Any questions? Any?
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for the comprehensive presentation. We will be sharing the video recording of this presentation as well to all the participants. Thank you very much, sir. And I think we can now move on to the next presentation from Dr. Arshad. Arshad, over to you. Sir, Sundaresan, sir, you have to...
All right, I'll stop sharing.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Arshad, over to you.
Yeah. Can you see my screen?
Can.
Yes, we can. We can, Dr. Arshad.
Yeah, I don't know whether it's a good morning or good afternoon. It's exactly 12 o'clock. Nice to meet you all in this presentation. I thank all the participants and other people. And Dr. Sundaresan, he has done a great job and made my job very easy because he discussed all the issues of dengue in detail. It's really a great, he discussed in a great detail. So I will go through with some other point where he didn't touch. Especially in the pediatric part. Otherwise, the dengue is the same, but when the fluid management and the little bit of changing in the presentation is different from the adult dengue. So I will go through a little bit the history. So when you know, when you go through this, dengue is one of the ancient disease. It's mentioned in ancient times books like Chinese encyclopedia or medical books also. It's like even before Christ, there are noted cases in 1992, the very first case mentioned in the medical literature. Then best known of the description dengue came in 1799. So that was the very best dengue case. And only 1960, only researchers found out that dengue are present with a mosquito bite. So before that, people thought it's some kind of disease caused by devils. So the name also came from the Latin word car denga pipo. So it's called like a devil disease. From that only the name also dengue arrived. So we know about that. Then first they have isolated virus in 1939. Then after 1970, it become an epidemic and all over it's there. So when you talk about the dengue viral infection, we should know there are different categories of people, especially in pediatric category. We see there are maybe asymptomatic cases. Mainly these type of patients are seen in adult, I think, adult young pediatric patients like 12, 13, 14 years, like or more than 18 years. Like sometimes it's like a COVID infection just passed without any symptoms. So we call it asymptomatic infection. And there are other people symptomatic, which are very important for us. So they are the people coming to us for their management or for their illness. When we take about this symptomatic, there are three categories. One is the undifferentiated fever. It's like the same viral fever, comes like a viral fever, goes like a viral fever, nothing happened. They recover without anything, just coming a fever for 3-4 days without any symptoms. Yes, it will go. Then the dengue fever also behave like a same. We are not worrying about any leaking in dengue fever. So it's like a same viral fever. No leakage. They are very well, like a viral fever, a little bit ill. Even there, we can manage it home safely without any issues. So sometime it present like very rarely expanded dengue syndrome. It's one of the rare presentations, so we don't want to discuss that. When you talk about the dengue fever, it may come with a bleeding, but it's a dengue fever. We should understand that whenever they brush or sometimes some ecchymotic bleeding, so whenever they brush some mucosal bleeding comes, but they are dengue fever, no need to worry about. Sometimes it's a dengue fever without bleeding also present. So most of the people say if the dengue fever presenting with bleeding, they are not leaking. So you have to understand that. Other one is the dengue hemorrhagic fever. Even though we say this is a hemorrhagic fever, actually there is no hemorrhage there. It's plasma leakage. So actually the name should come dengue plasma leakage fever. So the dengue hemorrhagic fever comes with shock or without shock. So our aim is to manage these two types of patients, whoever comes with a dengue fever or dengue hemorrhagic fever, and we have to monitor. Sometime these dengue fever people will go to a dengue hemorrhagic fever. So whenever they are entering to dengue hemorrhagic fever, we have to prevent them going to shock and manage appropriately. Sometime if they are coming with a shock, we have to reverse the shock and manage appropriately. That is our aim. So if we want to understand the management of dengue, we should understand the pathophysiology, dengue, and the natural cause of dengue. Then only we can see the big picture, what is going on, what is happening, why should I adjust the fluid, what should we give, whether we should give a dextran, we should give a normal saline, so we should go up with the fluid or come down the fluid. So we should understand the pathophysiology, otherwise it will be a difficult task. So once the dengue mosquito bites, Aedes aegypti, we know, the virus penetrates the skin. Then it replicates under the Langerhans cells, which are the immune protective mechanism in our skin. So then they release the interferon. They will go to the lymphatic system and make our lymphatic systems alert, and it will release into the circulation. So there are a lot of cytokines released into the circulation. During that time only, there will be, after the replication, there is a viremia, period of viremia, then the immunological reaction. So during that time, you will see the neutrophils will go up. There will be a neutropenia because of this immune response, and little bit low WBC also happens because of this immune reaction. Then there are pyrogens, many pyrogens released. They cause the fever. They increase sometime capillary leakage. So then it will happen like a dengue leaking syndrome. So when you see in this diagram, the mosquito bites, the virus entry into the skin cells, it's a hematopoietic origin cells. So then they will replicate there, then release their particles. So during this replication period of viremia, we will detect, as Dr. Sundaresan said correctly, NS1, non-structural protein 1. So we will see this NS1 during replication period, so during the viremia period. Then it will activate our our immune system, like especially in dendritic cell, macrophages and T cells. They present the virus to the macrophages and T cells. They secrete a lot of cytokines like interleukin 2-4 and gamma interferons, many cytokines. They increase the vascular permeability. This is the problem in a dengue hemorrhagic fever with other fevers. Whenever they increase the vascular permeability, we will see the leakage. Otherwise, so this is the issue here. In the vascular permeability, increase the leakage. So whatever fluid available here, the plasma, will leak outside of the blood vessel. So inside the blood vessel, there is less amount of fluid, more amount of cells. That means hemoconcentration is occurring. That's why our HCG is going up. Going up and up. So whenever there is a leakage is going up, the HCT also parallel to that is going up. You have to understand that. That's why we take the blood from the venous blood sample, and sometime even capillary sample we will take and see what is the HCT. It indirectly tells us there is a leakage. When the HCT is rising slowly, that means there is leakage slowly. If the repeat rise in the HCT, that means there is a repeat leakage in the blood vessels. So this is the pathophysiology. Usually they leak in the spaces like pleural space and the abdominal ascites like this. So this is the pathophysiology we should understand to time the dengue infection, to time the leakage, to understand our fluid management. Then we know there are three phases already mentioned, like a febrile phase, critical phase, and convalescent phase. The febrile phase usually long last, as he said, maybe 2 to 3 days, average around 5 days. It happens in both dengue fever and dengue hemorrhagic fever. So the febrile phase is the period where they usually come to a doctor, GP, or a consultant, or whoever the practitioner, with a history of fever. Usually dengue fever is very high fever, and you have to know during the epidemic, unless proven otherwise, whoever comes with dengue fever, whoever comes with any other fever, you have to take it as a dengue fever. Whoever comes with a fever, we have to take it until proven otherwise, that is the dengue fever. So then we won't miss any cases. We have to understand that. So usually it's a very high fever. The bone-breaking fever, the name before the dengue fever name comes, it's called bone-breaking fever. That much of pain, usually they are very ill. That is the good clinical presentation or differentiation there. From the symptoms, usually viral illness, people are in between fever. Once the fever settles, they are well. Children, they are well. They run around, they eat, they drink, they go around. Once the fever comes, they're a little bit ill, they sleep or they just take rest. But during the dengue fever, usually they are ill even in between fever. We have to understand that. Then it's give a little bit of clue that they may have a dengue fever, not the viral fever. So whoever comes with a very high fever, ill-looking, disproportionately ill-looking. We have to see that even the fever is a mild fever, but disproportionately the child is ill. That indicates they are the leakers. Usually if they are very ill, they are usually leakers. If they are a little bit of ill, the leaking may be low. Just from the clinical picture, we can take. Sometimes you may see the rash, facial flushing, skin erythema, but sometimes these are the late signs, so we can't wait. Other one is the retroorbital pain and the headache. It's usually they present with retroorbital pain and the headache, arthralgia, myalgia. Those are the features of associated features of dengue fever. Not from other viral fever also they can present, but usually common in dengue. If they comes with a severe nausea and vomiting, usually they are leakers. If they comes with severe nausea and the vomiting with a fever, they are usually leakers. They will leak, so we have to watch for it. Then we need full blood count and the plate. So full blood count, especially we need the WBC in the platelet, and we see the other hemorrhagic manifestations. So what are the other hemorrhagic manifestations? Sometimes you see a petechia, purpura, gum bleeding, sometimes hematuria, menorrhagia, usually you can see. If you see a WBC, initially it's a little bit high and it will drop slowly. Then platelet initially normal and it will drop. So once the platelet start to drop, cross the line of 100, many people say they are entering to the critical phase. The critical phase is the important one. We have to know it not long last more than 48 hours. Usually it goes around 24 to 48 hours in children. Not always third day. It may present in a second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day. We don't know. We have to time it correctly when they are entering the critical phase. That is the utmost important thing in the dengue management. Whoever going to the critical phase, we have to pinpointly identify them at what stage they went to the critical stage. Then only we can plan out our management without any problem. Then another one is the convalescent phase. Convalescent phase, once everything settled, sometime the febrile phase, without critical phase, they enter to the convalescent phase. Some children, they just a febrile phase, they enter to the convalescent phase without critical phase, but most will go to the critical phase, then become a convalescent phase. So that means we can relax the convalescent phase. We can relax our monitoring. We can move the patient from the HTU and we can space out our monitoring chart, or we can start oral fluid and plan to send home. So these are the features of convalescent phase. That during the convalescent phase, Dr. Sundaresan mentioned, so they will get a good blood pressure. They maintain their blood pressure throughout, good urine output. Sometime they develop a polyuria. Sometime they develop a itchy and convalescent rash, palm and sole itching and the rash. Those are the very good signs of recovery. So this chart already explained by Dr. Sundaresan. So I just go through that. So when you see this is the febrile phase and this is the leaking phase, or the critical phase, and this is the convalescent phase. During the convalescent phase, this fluids will be reabsorbed back into the circulation, into the vessels. So we have to careful about our fluid management, and we have to minimize the damage like pulmonary edema and heart failure, like complications of dengue hemorrhagic fever management. So we have to very careful about the fluid management during this convalescent phase. But during this initial febrile phase, we have to hydrate well, because there is a chance of going dehydration. So we have to hydrate well. I will manage. I will tell you how to do it. That then we have to prevent the shock during this and prevent the bleeding. The shock and the bleeding during the critical phase. This phase we have to be careful about our fluid management. So when you talk about the blood investigations, so initially the platelet start to drop, slowly drop below 100. Sometime leak may start even platelet above 100. So we can't say exactly all are leaking after the platelet crossing the 100 limit, no, around 105, 150, even sometime 200, some people may leak, but this is just a cutoff. So then once the platelet started to rising, if you get a two values of platelet rising, that means the patient is recovering. That's a good sign. then other one is the HCT. We have to monitor the HCT. So we have to do either capillary or venous. We have to see the rising HCT of 20%. If the rising HCT of 20%, like 35 to 42, like 40 to 48, that means they are entering to the critical phase. Then we have to identify the serology with the viremia. If the viremia, during this viremia period, you may find NS1 positive. So if you want to do a NS1, day one or day two, day three of the illness, you have to do NS1. You can get the high yield. So you can get the high positivity during that time. Once the child enter to the critical phase, NS1 may be negative. So we have to, we can't rule out only with NS1. So we have to find with the timing. So where the onset of fever, if you are going to do a NS1, you have to do it a day one or day two or day three. After day three and day four, the positivity become low. But the child started to produce IgM. Once the child viremia settled down, slowly the immune response will take over. So if after third or fourth day, around the fifth, sixth day, you will see the high level of IgM. The IgM will be very high. So that means the acute infection. If you see the IgG, that's mean the past infection, but the rising titer of IgG also will tell this is a secondary acute infection. So we have to understand. First few days, we can't differentiate dengue fever from dengue hemorrhagic fever. Both look same, but after the 2 to 3 days of fever only, the features of leaking will come. There are a few clinical signs like severe looking, streptovital headache, vomiting, abdominal pain. Those are the early signs of leaking, but very first few days, whoever comes with fever, either it's a dengue fever or dengue hemorrhagic fever, they behave. See, after 2-3 days only, they develop the features of leaking. So if the child comes with a dengue fever or dengue hemorrhagic fever, when you suspect the child comes with fever, either it's a dengue or dengue hemorrhagic, when do you suspect there is a leaking or they are going to the critical phase? So we have to think about these things. So if you see the headache and the retrovital pain, severe nausea and vomiting, the rash, these are the signs and symptoms, say they will go to the leak. So they will leak. Other investigation, like you have to see the low platelet count and the rising HCT. So those are the features will tell us patient is going slowly to the critical phase. So we have to watch, we have to do our investigation thoroughly and watch them and monitor them. So during the, we can manage all the dengue fever at the early stage as an OPD basis, home-based management. So we have to advise them clearly what to do and what not to do. So those are the very important things in the dengue fever management. If we know correctly, if this is the dengue fever, this is not entered to the leaking or critical phase, we can safely manage them at home without any issues. The very first thing is age-appropriate fluid requirement. You have to give adequate amount of fluid, no need to overload the patient. So you have to tell adequate amount of fluid you have to give to the patient. The pediatric population, you have to tell what to give. The better fluids are, you can give ORS, king coconut water, kanji, like rice-based kanji, and those things you can give, like fruit juices also you can recommend. But don't give just plain water. Some people only give throughout plain water. It will cause later electrolyte imbalance. So don't just give plain water, other red and brown colored drinks, because sometimes they vomit, we may be mistaken, it is as a hemorrhage. Or other thing is we have to give the fluid like 2 to 3 ml per kg per hour. We can give it in a 4 to 6 hours slot. It's easy for the patient. So every 4 hours, they have to give whatever fluid. It's either maybe a kanji or fluid, ORS, or it may be king coconut water, or even a fruit juice, whatever available, they have to give in 4 hour or 6 hour slot. It is easy for the patients or easy for the parents as well. So you have to target around 2 ml per kg per hour. So if a 10 kilo child comes, we have to give 20 ml per hourly. So 4 hours, we have to give 80 ml. So every 4 hours, at least, this is the least amount of fluid, at least they have to give 80 ml every 4 hours. Even they can give 100 ml, that is not an issue. There is no exact cutoff, but this is the minimum amount of fluid I'm telling. At least they have to target around 2 to 3 ml per kg per hour in 4 to 6 hours slot. So that is each. Then they have to take adequate physical rest. So they can't go to school, they can't go to tuitions, they can't go to playground. So they have to bed rest. Then the paracetamol. Many people come with a paracetamol overdose because the fever will not settle with paracetamol. Usually dengue fever, most of the parents tells you the fever will not settle, doesn't settle with the paracetamol. So that's true. So don't try them to give more paracetamol. It should be 50 milligram per kg per dose, only 6 hours apart. So maximum only 4 doses. Not recommend 4 hourly paracetamol, don't recommend. So only they can give every 6 hourly paracetamol, it's 15 milligram per kg per dose. We have to be careful about this paracetamol dose. Otherwise, during the leaking, already their liver failure is compromised, liver is compromised, the AST, ALT started to rise. So on top of that, if we cause a paracetamol toxicity, the management will be difficult. So we have to aim about, and we have to tell the parents, no need to bring down the fever to normal temperature. This is the dengue fever. It's very difficult. We have to explain them, this is very difficult to bring down the fever. Our aim is not to control the fever. Our aim is to manage the dengue fever and the dengue hemorrhagic fever. So we have to tell tepid sponging you can do, but don't give any NSAIDs or steroid. It was the scenario. So we have to avoid at any cost during the epidemic, during the dengue epidemic, don't give NSAID or steroid to anybody. Whoever comes with fever, don't give. That's a good practice. But from the day 2 onwards, once 48 hours completed, you have to do a full blood count and started the investigation. If the infant, if the patient is the infant, even day 1, day 2 count is necessary. So day 1, no need to do the count on the onset of fever. Day 2, once the 48 hours completed, you can do a full blood count with NS1. So that will give an idea whether this fever is a dengue fever or any other viral fever. Then we can manage from that. If the platelet count is less than 150,000, when you do on a day 3 or day 2, you have to do a count BD twice a day, morning 8 and evening. You have to do a count and see how the platelets is dropping. If the platelet is more than 150,000, your first count, no need to repeat the count. You can wait till next day with clinically, if the child is stable, you can do another count on the next day. So you have to do like the OPD management. You have to tell everything to the parents. You have to explain about what are the danger signs and everything. I will tell you during another few minutes. So what are the danger signs? You have to explain everything to the parents. Then they will come back. So once you have a suspicious of dengue fever, don't let them go. You have to review them the next day. Even they can go home safely, but the next day you should review them and see what is the procedure. It is just a dengue fever or whether he is going to a dengue hemorrhagic fever or plasma leakage. We have to monitor. Nobody can predict just seeing a patient at once and say this is dengue and this is dengue hemorrhagic fever. So throughout the time frame only, by monitoring and by gathering other data, we can tell this patient is going to dengue hemorrhagic fever and this patient just a dengue fever. So we have to get them back on next day and see whoever comes with a fever during dengue epidemic. Very first count, even normal, but don't let them go home. Repeat, get them back and see them whether they are okay and stable. You have to educate about the warning signs. So these are the warning signs you have to educate. If they can't take a fluid, severe vomiting, child is not taking any fluid, better to get admitted. So that warrant IV fluid, even they are not leaking. But we may give IV fluid because of vomiting, severe vomiting. Refuse to drink, eat, because they are very ill. They are very irritable. Universally, all the dengue children are irritable, very irritable. Like meningitis child, they are very irritable. They won't speak. They just sleep on the bed. Sometimes they are shouting or not listening to parents like that. They behave. So they won't drink. If they are not taking any fluid, they are not eating anything, better to get admitted. If there is a severe abdominal pain and vomiting, that's an early sign of leaking and involvement of liver, so better to get admitted. Other thing is always touch the peripheries. Whenever you examine a child with a fever during the dengue epidemic, always touch the extremity and see, especially dorsal impulse, like dorsalis pedis and posterior tibial, always try and see whether you can palpate, you can feel the pulse. If you can feel the pulse, that is the most distant part from your heart. That means all other pulses are normal. You can see safely the dorsalis pedis pulse and the capillary refilling time at the lower limb with warm peripheries. That means child is okay. But sometime in the practical issue, they bring the child in a three-wheeler. The both legs are outside from the three-wheeler. So due to the cold climate, you just see a cold periphery. Don't mistaken, it is a dengue leaking. So examine other pulses and see how is the clinical feature, is there, if there is any other signs of leak. Then look for the bleeding manifestation, whether there is hematuria. Sometimes young adult girls comes with a menorrhagia, with the vomiting, they can come with the blood stain vomiting. Check for urine output. Always advise them to check. If they are wearing a diaper, ask them to change the diaper every 6 hours early and see whether the diaper is wet or not. Otherwise, ask them to urinate and see. There is a good amount of urine. No need to monitor urine output during the febrile phase. Once the child enter to the critical phase only, we have to monitor. But for the safe practice, if the child is bigger, like around 4 years, 5 years, we can advise them to have an idea about what is going on. So they can monitor, they can measure the urine and record it for the purposes, like for our management. Then always look for behavioral changes like drowsy, irritable and restless. They may be the features of dengue encephalopathy. This is one of the rare complication and rare manifestation of dengue fever. So we have to warn about these signs. We have to tell each and every patient, whoever comes with the fever, about these warning signs. And whenever the warning signs appear, they have to report immediately to the hospital. So I already mentioned dengue antigen, 90% we can get positive report around day one, day two. So it's, if you do it early, it gives you a good yield. Otherwise, it's useless. Around day five, day six, maybe negative, it's misleading you. So if it is a dengue IgM and IgG, you have to do it in an early infection. Like day four, five, six, we will get an IgM positivity. That's mean an acute infection. If you have an IgG, it's a past infection. But the rising titer of IgG, you do a two values of IgG and see the rising titer, that means that is also acute infection. So these are the, this is the diagram of what I have said already. So you can see the virus replication phase nicely with the NS1 going with the same route. So during the replication phase, you will get an NS1 high. So once the replication over, viremia is over, you will start at the IgM rise. So you will peak IgM around day 4, 5, 6. Then IgG data will start and it persists for some time. So that means the past infection. So this is the criteria for admissions in a dengue fever. The platelet count less than 100,000, whatever the clinical picture, even it's a dengue fever, you have to admit them for the safe practice because we don't know what time they will enter to the leak, it's difficult to manage at home. So whoever comes with less than 100,000 platelet with the warning signs, better to admit them, like abdominal pain, tiredness, persistent vomiting, and cold extremities, sometimes the clinical features of fluid accumulation. This is the very earliest sign, like cold bladder thickness and ascites or pleural effusion by ultrasound scan. So if we can pick up that is the earliest sign, this will tell you the patient started leak. Once you detect ultrasonically the thickened gallbladder or gallbladder pouch edema, then you can say safely the child enter to the leak. Sometimes mucosal bleeding, lethargy, other thing is the hepatomegaly. So this is another good sign. Liver enlargement, more than 2 cm, hepatomegaly with tender liver. Almost always the tender liver, very tender. Whenever you keep your hand on the right hypochondrium, they will shout. You see a huge hepatomegaly, tender hepatomegaly, so that's mean they are leaking. Dengue fever comes with a hepatomegaly, it's tender, that's leaking. The lab evidence like less than 100 platelet and the rising HCT, we have to get the baseline HCT during the day one or day two. If we don't know the HCT, we have to take it around 35 to 40 like. Then you have to see the AST and ALT. Usually AST is rising more than ALT, STPT. If the AST rises around like 400, 500, even sometime it crossed the limit of 1,000, but STPT, ALT won't cross like that. But if you see a high rising ALT, then AST, STOT, STPT. So if it is more rise in the ALT, it may be a concurrent associated paracetamol overdose. We have to see that also. If you see unusual high rise in the ALT, that means there is underlying paracetamol or toxicity. So you have to get the good history of drug management. So other patients like obese, we have to admit them because you will find difficulty in cannulation and managing fluid. Other fine infants, any other comorbidities, like any other illness. So there are adverse social circumstances. They have no transport during the night. If they can't come during the night, so better to admit them. So if you see a patient evening with a platelet around 120,000, but you have a slight doubt whether there is a little bit of hepatomegaly and it's tender, so don't send them because platelet is just 120, don't send them, admit, because you have to ask about the social circumstance, whether they have a vehicle to come in the night in case of any danger sign appears. So you have to think about this as well. So in what management, the febrile phase, even you can manage it outpatients, that is not an issue, but we have to manage in the OPD basis usually, but in there are any other, if there are any other issues, you can admit the patient and manage, but ensure adequate fluid. You can manage with the oral fluid, no need to give IV fluid, but better to have a cannula. If the platelet is around 100, 120, better to have a cannula when you take a investigation, when you take a blood, better to have a cannula at that time. Either you can manage with the oral and IV fluid, both mix. It's dependent. Some people prefer to put a small amount of IV fluid, like around 0.5 ml per kg per hour, just to keep the vein open. And the rest of the fluid, around 1.5 ml per kg per hour oral. Or even you can give 2 ml or 3 ml, 2 to 3 ml per kg per hour orally in 4 to 6 hours slot. No need to wake up the child every hour and give the fluid, because we say it's hourly, but no need. It's dependent. If the big child, they can ring even 6 hourly slot. So if a 30 kilo child comes with febrile phase, so you can give 2 ml per hour. That means 30 into 2, 60 ml every hourly. So you can give in every 4 hours, 60 into 4, 240. So 250 ml, make it a round figure, 250 ml every 4 hours. That's easy for the parents. Then they wake up the child in another 4 hours and give another 250 ml. So that is easy. Don't give every hourly fluid, even though we say it's hourly. That's for our convenience, but make the patient's life comfortable at the board. So make them 6 hourly or 4 hourly fluid port. So they can sleep and they can take rest, especially in the night. So during the febrile phase, they are not entered the critical phase. There is a place of using 5% dextrose with normal saline, but better to use normal saline. So have a practice of using normal saline. You can give other nutrition through the mouth, so they can take other food, kanji, jivani, and other fluids like fruit juices. We have to monitor the child. You have to monitor the baby. You have to maintain the febrile phase monitoring chart. I think the one nursing officer will discuss that, how to do the monitoring. So you have to maybe a 4 hourly monitoring or 6 hourly monitoring. It depends on the 6 hourly or 4 hourly monitoring is enough. What are the parameters you have to monitor? You have to monitor the temperature. You have to monitor vitals. Then you have to monitor the full blood count. Depends on the initial count, whether it's daily or twice a day. The basic HCT depends on your HCT, whether you have to do a daily HCT or twice a day HCT. You have to decide on. This is the chart we use during the febrile phase. So once the child entered the critical phase, then we should alert all the staff. And sometimes if you have a HDU, better to move the child to the HDU or the close monitoring area. It may be nearby nursing station. So we have to warn the child. Sometimes you may have patients around 20, 30, 50 dengue patients, but only 1 or 2 leaker in the ward. So we have to make sure we give maximum attention to the leaker, not the rest. So no need to monitor them every 4 hourly at the crowd. So, but this one, we need a critical monitoring. That's why we call it critical phase. So once the child is entering to the critical phase, it's always long last around 48, maximum 48 hours. Some people will leak short leakers within 24 hours, they stop their leaking. But some people leak around 48 hours, like not more than 3 days. Within 48 hours, within 2 days, leak is over. So that's the critical period we have to manage adequately and safe. Usually it starts after day 3. Most of the time it's after day 3, but sometimes I have seen even day 2, sometimes even day 7, you can get a leak. At any time can happen, so you have to be careful. So the plasma leakage can cause shock. That's a worrisome sign. Or it's subsequent bleeding. If you are not managing the shock, it will go to the bleeding. Sometimes a multi-organ failure and the death. If there is shock, we can reverse it. If there is a subsequent bleeding, we can sometime correct it or may not. If there is an organ failure, it's difficult to reverse. So that's most of the time, 50% of the people will die once the multi-organ failure comes. It's very difficult to survive them. So don't let the children go to the multi-organ failure. Ultimately, they end up in death. So it's very difficult. So during the shock, we have to manage. We should not go them shock. If they come with a shock, we have to reverse the shock and manage adequately. So if any patient comes with a shock, the shock happens during the peak of the leak. We have to be careful about that. So that means almost leak reached the peak, patient entered the shock. So you have another 24 hours to monitor. That's sometimes some people may give, like Dr. Lokkuma giving a little bit of fluid. Let them go a little bit of when they reach the shock, they manage adequately and bring down the fluid, come down. Some people manage like that also. So you have to, other thing you have to understand, the rate of the leak, it varies. It may be around 1 ml per kg, maybe around 2 ml per kg, but it's sometimes it's a slow leaker, usually not more than 2 ml per kg, like Dr. Sundaresan said. It's usually not 7 ml, 8 ml, it's very rarely you will see a leaker like that, but that is also only for a little bit of time. So most of the leakers leak around 2 to 3 ml per kg per hour, like, so it varies. It's a dynamic disease. We can't fix them and fix the fluid just 2 ml. It varies. If 2 ml, it will go to 3 ml, then stop the leak and they will come back. So we have to monitor hourly. Every hourly, we have to monitor with other parameters and we have to predict the leak and we have to anticipate whether this leak is going up or it's coming down. According to that, we have to adjust the fluid because we don't have any drugs to stop this leaking. Once we have any, once we get any drug to stop the leaking, we don't want to talk about this fluid management. So now we have to only depend on this fluid because of the leaking. So according to leak, we have to match the leak and then manage the leak. So we have to predict. We have to calculate exactly when the leak started and we have to predict the peak when it will happen. According to that, we have to arrange the fluid. So, as I said, it's a very dynamic disease. So the hemodynamic state can change very rapidly to profound shock. And the child was coming, walking to the OPD and walking to the ward, but in 2-3 hours, he'll go to the shock. Maybe a repeat leak. So we have to be very careful with them. So we have to monitor them intensively every hour. So we have to identify each and every patient, the beginning of the critical phase and the end of the critical phase. Then it will help us to manage the fluid adequately without overloading or without giving liquid fluid. So as I said, platelet count dropping less than 100,000, it's maybe a dengue fever, it may be a dengue hemorrhagic fever, or they are entering into the critical phase. If we find other parameters like progressive rise of HCT more than 20%, 20% rise in the HCT is a good sign of leak. So we have to monitor the HCT every 4 hourly, sometime even every initially it's depend on BD, then every 4 hourly. Then if the leak critical phase onset, sometime even during the peak of leak, every hourly you have to do and see how to decide on your fleet. So always, if you find anyone with a critical phase, child is going for a critical phase, get another cannula. Have a 2 IV cannula for the safe practice. So one you can use for investigation, one you can use for fluid. So no need to prick each and every time. So if you have a 2 cannula, you can use another cannula to take every 2-hourly HCT or 4-hourly HCT, even ALT, AST, and other investigation, you can use that cannula. Other cannula, you can use for fluid management. Other good thing is if you have a 2 cannula, in case of one cannula is out, you have another cannula during the shock for the management. So always get 2 IVXs, especially in obese children, during the entering of critical phase, very early critical phase, start. No, don't wait till patient go to shock, or don't wait till the peak of the leak. Very early onset of leak, start putting 2 cannula, make it a good practice. So if you know the baseline HCT, take that. If you have a day 1 count, be careful about day 1 count. If the child comes with a vomiting during the dengue fever, the febrile phase, sometime you may see a right HCT. That's a false assurance. So we have to get a baseline HCT. Whenever child is not ill, during that time, what is the HCT? We know the past, if you have any full blood count during any other clinic visit for any other investigation. So if you have a count, just look at the HCT and see, make it as a baseline HCT. Or if you don't know, make it around 35. That's the basic HCT of a children. So if you see a rising HCT of 20%, that means the child entered the leak. How do you calculate? You have to take the baseline HCT and you have to take the current HCT minus baseline HCT into 100. So it gives you a more than 20% rise. That means child started leak. This is the very good evidence, objective evidence to say the leak. Nowadays, almost all pediatric board equipped with ultrasound. So you can train your staff, the on-call person or even ETU staff to do the scan. If there is a slightest doubt, they can just keep the scan probe and see the pleural effusion, ascites or gallbladder thickness. If there is an evidence, one of this, that means there is a definitive leak. So radiologically, we can detect even a little bit of leak, we can detect. Sometimes X-ray, you can do a lateral decubitus, but you have to wait for some time. That is not in the early leak. It's like almost half of the leak gone. Then you may see, if you have a doubtful other investigation, like serum albumin, if it is less than 3.5 gram per deciliter, that is the evidence of leak. Sometime non-fasting, just a random cholesterol sample, if it is less than 100 milligram, that is also indicating a leak. So nowadays, we can do a scan. That is the good clinical objective evidence. So if we can do a scan, that is good. So whenever child enter to the critical phase, our fluid management vary. This is the chart we use. So we have to calculate the time, date of the admission and the fluid. Then we have to assume when the critical phase started, when it is in need. Then only we can calculate the fluid quota. So calculating fluid quota is very important in pediatric patients, because most of the time, if we give fluid too much, they will end up in heart failure or pleural effusion or pulmonary edema later. So we have to calculate the fluid. We need an ideal body weight. So if you have a height for the weight, that's the best one. So you can have the chart with the height and the weight, that is the ideal weight. Or otherwise, weight for the age, you can use the 50th centile, or you can use this formula. Like 1 to 7 years, age into 2 plus 8 is a average the weight for this child. So if the average and ideal body weight are differ, you can take the lower one, the ideal body weight, or you can take in between. So if the child's body weight around 50 kilo, but the ideal body weight around 40, so you can take at a 45 for the calculation. You can take the weight as a 45. So we have to give adequate fluid without causing overload or without causing disturbance to the perfusion. That's our aim. So we have to give adequate amount of fluid that should not overload the patient and that should not compromise the organ perfusion as well. So that is our target. So the entire critical phase, for 48 hours of that critical phase, we have to get a maintenance plus 5% of the body weight. That means we are calculating a 5% loss of the fluid. So if you do the calculation like for a child with maintenance calculation, it's like first 10 kilos, you have to add 100 ml per kg for first 10 kilos. For the next 10 kilos, you have to add another 50 ml per kg for next 10 kilos. Even after 20 kilos, 20 ml per kg balance of the weight. Like if the child around 22 kilo, you see we'll add 100 into 10. So that's mean 1,000. Then here 50 into 10, another 500. So rest of the weight mean 2 into 20, 40. So this is the maintenance. You see 100 into 10 is 10 kilo. Then another 50 into 10, another 10 kilo. So 22 kilos, there are another 2 kilos. So 20 into 2. So 1,540 ml. This is the maintenance of the fluid. Then you have to add the 5% deficit. So 5% of the body weight into 50. That means 50 into body weight. So 50 into body weight, 22 kilo. So that is 5%. It's 1,200. So the total amount of fluid we are going to use is 2,640 for the entire critical. For the entire critical phase, we are going to use the fluid of 2,640. We are not going to use for the entire. Most of the time, we are not needing this amount of fluid. We have to understand, even you can manage with around 1,000, 1,500. No need to give this fluid as well. This is the maximum fluid you can go for. Don't go more than this. Okay? So, if the maximum weight exceed more than 50 kilogram, so you have to not exceed like adult patient 4,600 ml. Our fluid maximum should be 4,600 ml if the patient is more than 50 kilo obese child. So you have to careful about this fluid management. So we are calculating maintenance plus 5%. So how to calculate the maintenance? First 10 kilos, we take 100 ml for each kilo. Next 10 kilos, we take 50 ml for each kilos. Then next each kilos, we take 20 ml. Then we have to add another 5% of body weight at the deficit, like 50 ml into body weight. So this is the calculation. Hope you all understand. So how do you decide the rate of administration? So if the child is entering the critical phase, they starting a slow leak. Usually they start a slow leak. So you will start like 2 ml per kg. That's the good one. As Dr. Sundaresan said, that's a good practice. Start around 2 to 3 ml per kg per hour. According to the urine output and the parameter, you can adjust. If the child comes with tachycardia, very high low volume pulse, then wide pulse pressure, narrowed pulse pressure, the pulse pressure is we are aiming around 30. If it is narrowed pulse pressure, then you have to little bit of fluid you can give. If the child is already dehydrated, vomiting, then you can start around 4 or 5 ml per kg for 1 hour. Then you see in the next 1 hour, what is going on? What is it? The circulation improved, pulse pressure normalized, and the BP normal. You can see the good perfusion. You can see the peripheral pulse come down the fluid. So it's not the fixed fluid rate. Each and every hour, you have to adjust the fluid. Either you go up or you go down, depend on your predictions. So it's our target is we have to match the leak. We have to match the leak. So how do we identify the leak according to the parameters of the clinical parameters, the vital signs? So you can get a good guidance of the fluid management, whether you have to maintain the urine output around 0.5 to 1 number. So whether you need to catheterize or not, it's sometimes arguable because there is a neutropenia ongoing. So by catheterizing, you are additionally giving a risk to the child for the infection. So if the child can pass urine for every 2 hourly or even every 1 hourly at the request, no need to put catheterize. But if the patient comes with a shock and little bit ill, very difficult to get a urine, better to have a catheter. So then you can get a urine output. So if the urine output is after giving of fluid, if the urine output coming more than 1 ml, that means our fluid is too much. We are giving too much fluid, so we can cut down the fluid. So if you start at the fluid around 3 ml per kg, in the next 2 hours, like you will see, if the urine output is coming around 2 ml, that means we are giving too much of fluid, so you can slowly come down to 4 ml and you monitor next hour. So if you are giving 2 ml, another example, if you are giving 2 ml of fluid, but in next 2 hours time, you will wait and see the urine output is less than 0.5 ml, still tachycardia persists, then pulse pressure is narrow. So the capillary refilling time not improve. So you can go off the fluid. So this is the chart, the hypothetical situation. Most they behave like this. People believe like started the leaking around 1 ml, 1.5, 3 ml, 5 ml, going for a 7 ml during the peak. This is not always true. Sometimes people go like this, and they stop the leak and come like this. This also can happen. Or sometimes people go like this, very rapidly go like this, and they will go like this as well. Or some people, the slow leakers, very go like this, and they stop the leaking like this as well. These are the variable clinical presentation we have seen during dengue epidemic. So not always true. This is not always true, but you can take it as a guide. They are not leaking this much rate, never. Only very few patients leak this much rate. So, but you can adequately maintain around the fluid 2 to 5 ml per kg. You go up little. If you are going more than 5 ml per kg, you have to be very careful because you will exceed your quota very soon. If you are running a fluid 5 ml per kg more than 2 to 3 hours, like you will out of your quota very soon. So you have to be careful and you have to get a second opinion from your seniors whether the child is going for a shock or whether it's a place of giving dextra rather normal saline. So whether you have to think about. So if you can't, don't run too much of fluid, like 10 ml per kg more than 2 to 3 hours. So that means you are not managing the shock properly. If you give 10 ml per kg around 1 to 2 hours, you have to reverse the shock and you have to come down the fluid. You are giving too much of fluid, that means you can't match the leak. So that's an indication you have to go for a dextran. So it's molecularly active particles. They form a large molecule and stay inside the circle for a long time, and it helps you to reverse the shock. So you have to be careful with that, either or otherwise it's a bleeding. So if you are giving too much of fluid for a long period, that means there is a concurrent bleeding, you have to give a bleed. So you have to be careful. So exceeding fluid more than 5 ml for a longer period, that means you are not managing, you are not getting a desired effect. There are some other underlying issues, either it's they are going for a shock or there is a bleeding. So you have to be careful. So you have to look for other signs of ABCS, like with acidosis or bleeding or shock. Or those. So how do you manage the shock? You should know these are the symptoms of the shock. If the patient in the ward, if they complain severe sweating, abdominal pain, restlessness, and altered level of consciousness, that means they are entering the shock. Always, I mentioned earlier, check for the extremities. They are cold, then you have to palpate and see the mid, where is the cold line, maybe around ankle, around middle of the lower limb, or around up to knee, sometime even up to elbow. Oh, that means they are in a shock for a long time. So check the extremities, especially leg, lower limbs, check the extremities and check the lower limb pulse. Always check the capillary refilling time. It's better place. You can, the children, you can just check over the chest, sternum. That's a good, if it should be less than 2 seconds. If it is more than 2 seconds, that means there is a prolonged capillary refilling time. So there is a poor perfusion. It's indirectly mean there is a poor perfusion. The other thing is the unexplained tachycardia. So once you give a fluid, tachycardia should settle. But if there is a unexplained tachycardia, always think is there is a bleeding. Concurrent bleeding is there. There is ongoing bleeding. Always check the tachycardia. Once you give enough fluid, tachycardia comes return to normal. So the pulse, like a pulse volume, the pulse rate also is a good indicator to give the clinical picture. Then another one is the narrowing pulse pressure. So increasing diastolic blood pressure, that's mean the narrowing pulse pressure. Our aim is to keep more than 30 to, if it is coming below 30, that's mean entering. If it is below 20, that's mean not acceptable level. So you have to maintain your pulse pressure in between 20 to 30, the desired value is 30. So don't let that pulse pressure go 30. Then check for the urine output every 4 to 6 hours. So if there is no urine output more than 4 hours, that means patient in the shock. But if the patient is catheterized, always check for the catheter block. But don't take a single parameter as a value. Sometimes early midnight, like early morning, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, you are managing a patient or running a small fluid. They are recovering nicely. You are cut down fluid, the pulse volume good, the pulse pressure very good, capillary refilling time very good. Suddenly urine output becoming low. So don't take it as a severe leaking, or it's maybe it's a normal effect because you have our perfusion pressure will go down in the midnight. That's why we are not waking up in the night to pass urine. That's a normal physiological phenomena. So always relate with other features. Don't take a single feature as an indicator for leaking. You have to take your pulse pressure. You have to take your blood pressure. You have to take your periphery warmness or the cold extremity, pulse volume. So all the indicators together, then you have to point out. So if it is shock, always call for help. Inform your senior in advance, get the help from protect the airway. So you may give oxygen through the face mask, ensure adequate circulation, get IV access as soon as possible. Keep the flat head low to maintain your central nervous system perfusion. So this is the algorithm. If the patient comes with a narrow pulse pressure with a shock, so it's an early shock. That means if you're coming with a patient early shock, you can give a bolus, 10 ml per kg, our normal saline. You can repeat either. You can do bolus or one bolus, then see the response. How do you see the response? Always the clinical parameters. Pulse rate, capillary BP, pulse pressure, capillary refilling time, urine output, NHC. Then if there is a no response after giving a 1 hour bolus, there is a no response, then if the HCT is rising, not coming down, so you have to check whether there are any other causes like ABCS, acidosis, or bleeding. You have to check for that. This time, when any patient comes with a shock, when you put a cannula, take a blood for DT. Always in advance, send it grouping and DT, and get ready with the blood of the patient coming with whenever you put a cannula, dengue entering a critical phase, you are suspecting a patient is entering the critical phase, or on admission, if the patient comes with a shock, whenever you put a cannula, always take the blood body, don't forget, and send the routine other investigation as well. So if other patients comes with a profound shock, it means you can't palpate the pressure, you can't record the blood pressure, or you can't feel the pulse. So you have to give repeat bolus. As soon as possible, you have to give like a very running push. You have to give a fluid push, 10 ml per kg or 20 ml per kg. Until you record the blood pressure, you have to give as soon as possible, as fast as possible. Then once you feel the pulse, you can come down slowly and set the rate. Then you can give a change to a normal saline, 10 ml per kg power, then you can cut down slowly. Once you corrected the pulse, then you will cut down 7 ml per hour, 6 ml per hour, 5 ml per hour, like that you can cut down. If there is a no response, that means you have to go for a dextran. So if there is dextran, you have to bring down the PCV. Not with the high PCV, you can't give the dextran, 10 ml per kg hourly. So you have to give a fluid before giving dextran. Better to give a good perfusion. Then only dextran will make a large molecule inside the vessels and keep more fluid. Otherwise, it will give adverse events. So you have to assess the ABC. Then if you give an adequate amount of fluid, one fluid bolus, second fluid bolus, no response, go for a dextran. So if you give a dextran over 1 hour, then everything will settle. Most of the time, everything will settle. We rarely we give blood. I have seen many leakers, but I have seen given only 1 or 2 times blood transfusion. With dextran, most of the people will settle, even the shock will, we can reverse the shock. Then if there is a no response, then according to, you have to adjust. So if there is, as Dr. Sundaresan mentioned, if you see a shock patient with a low HCT, that means there is a bleeding. The bleeding already there, it's warrant for the blood transfusion. So you have to give. So not rising HCT, indicating underlying bleeding. So during the shock, we know the pathophysiology, the fluid leakage goes out, the plasma is going out, so HCT should go up. If the HCT is not going up, that means somewhere patient bleeding. So somewhere bleeding means the HCT is not rising. So if there is a During the shock, if there is a no HCT rise, always think about bleeding. So it's warrant for the blood transfusion. Then you have to check other ABCs like acidosis. If the pH is 11, less than 7.35, you can give bicarbonate. The bicarbonate less than 15 millimol. So you have to do a blood test during the shock. If they are managing a shock, always get a blood test as well and see correctly. If you correct the acidosis, you can reverse the shock very quickly. So it prevents the bleeding as well in the dengue hemorrhagic fever. So it will prevent DIC and the bleeding. So you can give 1 ml per kg sodium bicarbonate, more or less, with diluted same amount of saline. So if a 10 kilo child, you can take 10 ml bicarbonate, add it into the 10 ml normal saline, and you can add it to the infusion. So it is common in the profound shock. If it is bleeding, that means that it's overt bleeding. We call it a concealed bleeding, the PCV drop without improving. So that means you have to use a 5 ml per kg blood. It's increased, once you give a blood, it should increase our HCT by 5 points, like dextran. It should increase our HCT. Don't give blood without bleeding. If there is bleeding, you have to use very cautiously. Even we have managed several patients, like several leakers, but only one or two cases needed blood transfusion. So it's very rare. You are going to give a blood, get a second opinion from other, your colleague or your senior fellow or with other consultant, and discuss before giving blood. The another one is the hypocalcemia. It's common in dengue hemorrhagic fever, especially in latecomers, especially shock people. So that may lead to a convulsion. So hypocalcemic convulsion. So if there is a severe leak and the shock, you can give calcium during the infusion. You can put 1 ml per kg, 10% calcium gluconate into the slow infusion, but better to get a calcium level. Whenever you send a leaking profile, send serum calcium as well. Or you can, if you have HTU, you can monitor the QT interval, the ECG and C. So you can give, if there is a hypocalcemia, you can give calcium during your management. After the giving fluid boluses, you can add the calcium. Other thing is hypoglycemia. Always look for hypoglycemia. Even you can check the capillary sugar, because they are severely vomiting, not taking anything orally. And on top of that ongoing infection and the immune function, they will become hypoglycemic very soon. So it's common in dengue hemorrhagic fever. Always check every sugar in 4 hourly, at least 6 hourly time. If it is less than 70 milligram per liter, you can give a bolus of dextrose 10 ml, 2 ml per kg, 10% dextrose. You can give an infusion. So as soon as possible, you have to correct hypoglycemia and you have to monitor. Sometimes they may present with hyponatremia in common in some complicated dengue. If you are using N by 2, we are not using nowadays this, or due to water. They are only giving water during the fluid management. If you are giving only water, there is a high chance of getting hyponatremia. So you have to correct that whenever you give normal saline. It will be usually corrected. So if you are using normal saline, you can correct it. If the child is taking orally, always encourage them to take ORS, fruit juices, king coconut water as a oral fluid. Or otherwise, you can give 3% normal saline. If there is a severe hyponatremia, you can use 3% normal saline in a symptomatic patient. If they develop a hyponatremic convulsion or hepatic encephalopathy, very rare cases, you see the sodium very low, then you can use 3% sodium chloride bolus via the large vein. So these are the main causes in the deck. That means in a dengue hemorrhagic fever, most of the people die due to the prolonged shock. So if you manage the shock, you are the winner. We can reverse the patient and we can send the patient home with happy parents. So if you manage the shock nicely with adequate fluid, we can reverse. If they enter to the liver failure, 50% will die. If they enter to the liver failure and renal failure, only 50% will survive. If they enter to the liver failure and renal failure, only 10% will survive. If more than 3 organ involvement, very poor prognosis, almost all will die. So the prognosis is bad. You manage the shock properly, we can reverse the patient. So don't let the patient in shock more than 4 hours. as soon as possible, within 1 or 2 hours, you have to correct the shock. That's why we have to monitor every hourly or 2 hourly during the critical phase to reverse the shock. Once you reverse the shock between 2 hours, the outcome is very good. We can get a normal outcome. If the patient entered the shock more than 4 hours, that starts the multi-organ dysfunction mode, MOD. So if multi-organ dysfunction comes, the prognosis becomes bad. MOD give you a bad. So it's post the liver failure, renal failure, multi-organ dysfunction. Other cause of death, mainly fluid overload. Nowadays, it's minimum because of we are using a little bit of fluid because of awareness type of these programs and other things. We are now giving adequate amount of fluid. We are not overloading fluid. If you are giving overloaded fluid, you can use acids like furosemide. Early furosemide will help you to the management in the fluid overload during the convalescent phase, not during the critical phase. Even the critical phase, sometime you can use, but once the leaking stop and child is in the descending limb, not in the ascending limb. So the leaking going up and up, you can't use furosemide, but if the leaking settling down, but there is a fluid overload, you can use furosemide safely. It's better, as Dr. Sundaresan said, we can use with a colloid. Like you can give it 5 ml per kg Dextran with 1 ml per kg furosemide infusion. It will take out the fluid. It's easy. We can manage easy. Sometime you may, these are the features of fluid overload. Always look for these puffy eyes, eyelids, ascites, acypnea. Always check the saturation, mild dyspnea, prop up the child. And always look for basal entry crepitations. So if you find those things, that means there is a fluid overload. Other signs are late, like desaturating, severe hypoxia, confusion, those are the late signs. So pick up early signs. So always check for the lung bases for crepitations and see whether there are puffy eyes and ascites or tachypnea. Then even you can check the saturation. So if we find administering furosemide will you a good result. Sometime you may see a rare presentation like dengue encephalopathy, dengue encephalitis, or severe bleeding. These are the very rare presentations. So now we are reaching the end part. So the convalescent phase, so we all are happy once we reach the convalescent phase, that means child is recovering. It will may long last another 2 to 5 days. That's during the convalescent phase, whatever fluid leak out comes to the circulation. So we have to be very careful. That's why we are not giving too much fluid during the critical phase, because whatever fluid went out from the circulation, blood vessel will come back to your circulation. It will cause sudden cardiac failure or pulmonary edema. So we have to be careful. We can't discharge the patient, even the convulsion rests there. We have to at least two to three days, we have to keep them and see the rising platelet, nicely rising platelet. Some people wait till platelet comes 100,000. Some people wait, it's 50 to 70,000, like it's depend on the clinical condition. And there is a polyuria. So if they are passing a polyuria, then you can aid with a little bit of furosemide to reabsorb the fluid and you can manage nice. So usually appetite will improve. Once they enter the critical phase, they started eating. So when you go to the ward round, if the child is sitting and eating, that means he entered the critical phase. Then you may see the convalescent rash, especially in the palm and sole, itching rash. So don't mistakenly take it as a dengue leaker entering the critical phase. This is the convalescent rash with the itching. That is a good sign. Usually body itching, they are hemodynamically, they are stable. You see a very good bounding pulse. The pulse volume is very high because fluid, too much of fluid is coming to the circulation. So you get a good bounding pulse, good blood pressure, good urine output. And a bradycardia, you will get a bradycardia. Usually, tachycardia settle and become a bradycardia. That's mean he entered critical phase already. And you see the diuresis, that's mean polyuria around 5 ml per kg, 5-7 ml per kg, sometimes even 10 ml per kg urine output, you can see. And you see the stabilized HCT, it's not rising any. The HCT drop is there, maybe lower than the baseline. Sometimes you may get HCT of 33, 32, or 30 even. And you see the start of rising WBC. Initially, you see WBC start to rise, then later platelet follow the trend. So during the complication, the convalescent phase, we get complication. I have discussed the fluid overload. Sometimes you may get hypokalemia because of fluid, lot of fluid coming inside. So always give oral supplement. Like you can advise them to take a lot of fruit juices, like king coconut water, it's good one. Banana, other one is the pomegranate. That's a good potassium supplements. So even you can sometime give oral KCL tablet, but very rarely we need IV. So you can give oral potassium supplement, or you can give oral fresh fruit juices. Then I discussed already the fluid overload. Other thing is the nosocomial infection because of neutropenia. So if you put a catheter, you kept the catheter for a longer period. So whenever child's recover, remove the catheter as soon as possible. Don't keep the catheter for a long period. So it induces the infection. So sometimes if there is a persistent neutropenia, you can give antibiotic like coamoxiclav or amoxicillin. It will treat. Sometimes they can, with lung, it will give a good environment for the lung organisms to grow and give a pneumonia. So you have to care for it. So if the child is starting to get a fever again, once the fever settled during the critical phase, if the once the recovery, if the child is getting fever, that means that's nosocomial infection. The child is getting fever, that means there is an infection somewhere, maybe a UTI or maybe a lower respiratory tract infection. So always watch for this and treat this. So when to discharge, there may be the last slide. If there is no fever more than 24 hours, recovery rash appeared, then no more management needed for fluid, taking orally, a child eating well, appetite improved, HCT maintained throughout normal, no distress, no difficulty in breathing, no ascites. When you auscultate and see if there is ascites, a dullness, you can't. Once the ascites settled, the platelet rising more than 50,000, you can discharge. There is no other complication, safely discharge. But always get down in 2 weeks' time and check whether they have get a normal full blood count. Sometimes there are cases identified because they will go into low platelet persistently because of some people even identified leukemia as well. So concurrent leukemia detected after that. So after 2 to 3 weeks, you have to see a normal full blood count. So get down the patient and see whether they have got normal count or not. That's a good practice. I think I have finished, entirely covered all the section. If you have any doubt, you can ask.
Thank you, Dr. Arshad, for the comprehensive presentation with all the practical aspects of dengue management in children. If you have any questions, you can raise hand and we can allow you to ask. We will be sending these presentations to all the participants via email. So if you have any questions, you can directly email to us as well. We can forward it to Dr. Arshad for any clarification as well.
I hope there will be no questions. So I will wind up. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Arshad. We will go for the next session. Now we will be going for the next presentation from Ms. Rajmi, a nursing officer from Ashraf Memorial Hospital. Over to you, Ms. Rajmi.
Good afternoon. I am Rajmi Ahmed Levine, Pediatric Ward, Ashraf Memorial Hospital. Non-presentation Tamil Nadu. Dr. Sundarishan Muthi sir and Dr. Arshad sir, dengue fever, dengue hemorrhage fever, Patiala Hamla Kasulinanga. Non dengue fever, dengue.
Rajmi Ahmed, sir, presentation model.
Presentation. Hello, ரெஸ்பிரேட்டரி ஃபியூஷன் அந்த 8th தேதி வரைக்கும் அதே டோஸ் ஓட போய் சொல்லி இருக்கறாரா ம்
சரி
சார் ஐ மீன் 200 பிடி போல் சார் இத லிப்ரியம் மிக் பண்ணிட்டாங்க அத ரெஸ்பிரடோன் 0.5 பிடி போல் சார் ஆன்டிபயாட்டிக் மிக் பண்ணாங்க மைக்ரோபயாலஜி மேடம் சொல்லி இப்ப சார் இன்டர்மிட்டன்ட் என்ஆர்பிஎம் என்ஐவி போல் சார்
ஓகே
சார் ஹை ஃப்ளோ நேசல் ஆக்ஸிஜன் அண்ட் என்ஐவி மேட்டது இப்ப சார் இப்ப சச்சுரேஷன் 99 மெயின்டைன் ஆகுது மேட்டுப்படி லிவர் ஃபங்க்ஷனும் கமிங் டவுன் சார் அல்ட்ராசவுண்ட் அப்டோமென்டல் ஃபேட்டி லிவர் இருந்தது
ஓகே
பெரிய
குட் ஆஃப்டர்நூன் ஃப்ரம் பீடியாட்ரிக் வாஷ்ரூம் மெமோரியல் ஹாஸ்பிட்டல் கலந்து நான் ப்ரெசன்டேஷன் தமிழ்ல செய்ய போறேன் டாக்டர் சுந்தரேஷன் முத்தி சார் அண்ட் டாக்டர் அஷர் சார் டெங்கு ஃபீவர் டெங்கு ஹெமரேஜ் ஃபீவர் பற்றி எல்லாம் விளக்கம் சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க நான் டெங்கு ஃபீவர் அண்ட் டெங்கு ஹெமரேஜ் ஃபீவரை எப்படி பேஷண்ட் அப்சர்வ் பண்ற மானிட்டர் பண்றது இங்க பார்க்க போறோம் ring word monitoring of dengue fever and dengue hemorrhage fever a good understanding of the disease process will help the proper management which will lower the degree of morbidity and mortality உங்களுக்கு இந்த டெங்கு பத்தி சரியா விளக்கம் தெரிஞ்சிருந்தா நாங்க மேனேஜ்மெண்ட்க்கு யாரோ பேஷண்ட் கொடுக்கறதுக்கு அந்த நோய் நிலையோட தீவிரத்தையும் இறப்பையும் குறைக்கிறதுக்கு எங்களுக்கு ஒரு ஹெல்ப் ஆகும் இதுல மூணு ஃபேஸஸ் இருக்கு ஃபெப்ரைல் ஃபேஸ் critical phase convalescent phase இதெல்லாம் நாம febrile phase பாப்போம் febrile phase ல observe the symptoms high fever headache abdominal pain nausea vomiting gum bleeding nasal bleeding hematuria menorrhagia lethargy reduced intake இந்த மாதிரியான symptoms நாம observe பண்ணினா immediately inform the doctor monitoring the during febrile phase there temperature vital parameters intake output full blood count daily or twice pc twice daily nama monitor pannum idhula nama temperature four hourly chart la idhu mari check pannum four hourly la day 1 day 2 day 3 engalukku day 3 la
resume means nammada presentation move pannad illaya ஒரு ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஸ்லைட்ல இருக்கு.
சரி.
அது பிரசன்டேஷன் மோட்ல போடுங்க. உங்களுக்கு போய் அந்த பிரசன்டேஷன் மோட் ஆயிடுச்சு.
இப்போ ஓகேவா?
இல்ல பிரசன்டேஷன் ஷேர் பண்ணிட்டு ரொம்ப பிரசன்டேஷன் ஷேர் பண்ணுங்க. ஷேர் பண்ணிட்டேன். பிரசன்டேஷன் இன்னும் ஷேர் பண்ணுங்க. ஆ ரைட் ஓகே சார் பிரசன்டேஷன் மாதிரி போடுங்க ரைட் ஓகே அதுல
இப்போ ஓகேவா?
அத மெயில் டு ஸ்லைட் ஷோ யா சரி
இப்போ இப்போ சரியா?
இல்ல
போடுங்க
In what monitoring, dengue fever, dengue hemorrhage fever, இதுல நம்ம மூணு ஃபேஸஸ் இருக்கு. ஃபெப்ரைல் ஃபேஸ், கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ், கன்வலசன் ஃபேஸ். ஃபெப்ரைல் ஃபேஸ்ல சில சிம்டம்ஸ் என்ன அப்சர்வ் பண்ணோம்னாங்க, ஹை ஃபீவர், ஹெடேக், அப்டோமினல் பெயின், நோசியா அண்ட் வாமிட்டிங், கம் ப்ளீடிங்.
டவுன் அரோவா பிரஸ் பண்ணிப்போம் அப்படியே.
Nasal bleeding, hematuria, menorrhagia, lethargy, reduced intake. In the madriyana symptoms namo observe pannukulla inform to doctors. Illa monitoring during febrile phase la namo temperature, vital parameters, intake output, full blood count PC twice daily.
பாரு
temperature வந்து temperature chartல பார்க்கணும். 4 hourly chart. temperature 4 hourly பார்க்கணும். temperature chartல நாம fever தொடங்கின நாள் தொடக்கம் அது நாம மார்க் பண்ணுவோம். அப்பதான் எங்களுக்கு ஃபெப்ரைல் ஃபேஸ்ல இருந்து கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ் எங்க போகுதுன்றத மானிட்டர் பண்ணிடுவோம். ஏன்னா எங்களுக்கு ரெபிட் ட்ராப் டெம்பரேச்சர் எந்த பாயிண்ட்ல வருதுன்றத அப்சர்வ் பண்ண எங்களுக்கு டெம்பரேச்சர் சார்ட் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இந்த ஃபீவர் டெம்பரேச்சர் சார்ட் இதுல ஃபெப்ரைல் ஃபேஸ்ல ஃபீவர் இருக்கும்னு சொன்னா நம்ம டாக்டர்ஸ் ஆர்டர்ஸோட பாராசிட்டமால் வந்துட்டு 10-15 மில்லிகிராம் பர் கேஜி பர் டோஸ் படி கொடுக்க வேணும். இதுல எடிக்குவேட் பிசிக்கல் ரெஸ்ட் இருக்க வேணும். டெபிட் ஸ்பாஞ்சிங் பண்ணிடும். அவாய்ட் ஆல் என்எஸ்ஏ ஐடிஎஸ் அண்ட் ஸ்டீராய்ட். வைட்டல் பராமீட்டர்ஸ்ல நம்ம ஹார்ட் ரேட், ரெஸ்பிரேட் ரேட், பிளட் ப்ரெஷர், போத் சிஸ்டோலிக் அண்ட் டயஸ்டோலி, பல்ஸ் ப்ரெஷர், இதுல கேபிலரி ரீஃபில் டைம், இது எல்லாத்தையும் நாங்க மானிட்டரிங் சார்ட் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் சார்ட்ல பார்ப்போம். இந்த மானிட்டரிங் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் சார்ட்ல எங்களுக்கு platelet, PCV, heart rate, blood pressure, pulse volume, extremely warm or cold, CRFT, respiratory rate, input, output, இது அவ்வளவும் மானிட்டரிங்ல எங்களுக்கு வருது. நாங்க எங்க ஹோட்ல இங்க யூஸ் பண்றது. இதுல மெயின் பீடியாட்ரிக் சைட்ல வந்துட்டு வெயிட் முக்கியம். இந்த வெயிட் நாங்க எடுத்துட்டு ஃபெப்ரவரி பேஸ்ல வர இதை நாங்க 4 hourly மானிட்டர் பண்ணுவோம். In the heart rate, BP, pulse volume எல்லாம் இதுல ஏதாவது சேஞ்சஸ் வர்ற நேரம் நாங்க இமீடியட்டா டாக்டர்ஸுக்கு இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ண வேணும். இதுல இன்டேக் அவுட்புட் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இன்டேக் வந்துட்டு போதுமான அளவுக்கு இன்டேக் எடுக்கக்கூடிய பிள்ளைகளுக்கு மதர்ஸ்க்கு நாங்க அட்வைஸ் பண்ணிடலாம். கிங் கோகோனட் வாட்டர், ஃப்ரூட் ஜூஸ், கஞ்சி, சூப், அதோட பிளான் வாட்டர்ஸ் கொடுக்கலும். இதுல ரெட் ப்ரௌன் ட்ரிங்க்ஸ்ல அவாய்ட் பண்ண சொல்லி சொல்ல வேணும். ஆர்டிபிஷியல் ட்ரிங்க், சுகர் ஆட் ஃப்ளூயிட்களையும் நாங்கள் அவாய்ட் பண்ண சொல்றது. ஏன்னா எங்களுக்கு அவுட்புட் எடுக்கிற டைம்ல ஆர்டிபிஷியல் ட்ரிங்க், சுகர் ஃப்ளூயிட் எடுக்கக்குள்ள ஆஸ்மாலிட்டியால யூரின் அவுட்புட் போடும். அப்ப எங்களுக்கு சரியான கல்குலேஷன் யூரின் அவுட்புட்ல எடுக்கலாம் போயிடும். அதே நேரம் எங்களுக்கு வர சைல்டுல டயரியா, வாமிட்டிங், டிஹைட்ரேட் இருக்கும்னு சொன்னாலோ, இல்லை போதிய அளவுக்கு ஃப்ளீட், ஓரல் ஃப்ளீட் இன்டேக் எடுக்கலன்னு சொன்னாலோ நாங்கள் இமீடியட்டாக இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ண வேணும் டாக்டர்ஸ்க்கு. அவங்களுக்கு இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ணி ஃப்ளீட் தேவைப்பட்டால் நாங்கள் மெயின்டெனன்ஸு ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ண வேணும் டாக்டர்ஸோட சொல்ல. அவங்களோட டீஹைட்ரேஷன் பாடானது செட்டில் ஆகி குறைஞ்சி வர காட்டிலும் நாங்கள் அந்த கண்டினியூ பண்ண வேணும் ஐ ஃப்ளீட். இது எங்களுக்கு நாங்கள் ஓட்டில் கொடுத்த இன்புட் அவுட்புட் சார்ட். இதில் நாங்கள் டைம் 24 ஹவர்ஸுக்கு இது இருக்குது. இதில் என்னென்ன ஃப்ளீட் நாங்கள் டைப்பான ஃப்ளீட் கொடுக்குறோமோ அந்த ஃப்ளீட்டை நோட் பண்ணி எவ்வளோ அமௌண்ட் நாங்கள் ஒரு பாடி வெயிட் கல்குலேஷன் பண்ணி கொடுக்க இயலும் அந்த கல்குலேஷனுக்கு ஏற்ற மாதிரி எம்எல் பர் கேஜியில் ஃப்ளீட் கொடுக்கப்படும். இதே நேரம் யூரின் அவுட்புட் மதர்ஸுக்கு நாங்கள் இதில் மதர்ஸ் சப்போர்ட் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட், அதனால நாங்கள் மதர்ஸுக்கு இந்த சார்ட் அவுட்புட் சார்ட் கொடுக்குறது. ஒவ்வொரு 3 hours கொடுக்காவும் யூரின் அவுட்புட் கலெக்ட் பண்ண வேணும் மதர்ஸ். அப்படி மதர்ஸ் 1 hourly அவங்களுக்கு அவுட்புட் எடுக்கிறது கஷ்டம், ஃபிளீட் கொடுக்கறதும் கஷ்டம்னு சொன்னால் 3 hourly யூரின் அவுட்புட் எடுக்கிற 3 hourly யூரின் அவுட்புட் நாங்கள் கலெக்ட் பண்ணக்குள்ள மதர்ஸுக்கு சில வேலை இரவையில் பிள்ளைகள் தூங்குற டைமில் எழும்பாது. அந்த நேரத்துக்கு நாங்கள் யூரினுக்கு எழும்புற டைமில் எங்களோட ஃப்ளீட் கோட்டா ஃப்ளீட் பேலன்ஸ் பண்ணுறதுக்காக 2 hourly என்று சொன்னால் நாங்கள் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஹவர்லி உதாரணத்துக்கு 20 ml per kg கொடுக்குறோம் அப்படின்னு சொல் 20 ml அப்படி கொடுக்குறோம்டா 2 hours 3 hours 60 ml அந்த பிள்ளைக்கு சேர்த்து கொடுக்க இயலும். அந்த மாதிரி அட்வைஸ் பண்ண இயலும். சலம் போகிற டைமில் பிள்ளைக்கு ஓரல் டாகட்டை கொடுக்குறதுக்கு என்ன எங்களுக்கு ஒவ்வொரு ஹவருக்குரிய ஃப்ளீட்டும் மிஸ் ஆகாமல் பார்த்துக்கொள்ள வேணும். இதில் நாங்கள் ஸ்தலம் வந்துட்டு இந்த மாதிரி டியூப் எங்களோட போர்டில் கட் பண்ணி ஒரு நார்மல் சிலிண்டர் கட் பண்ணி மெஷர் பண்ணி கொடுப்போம். இதில் 50 ml விட குறைய இருக்கிற அவுட்புட்டுக்கு நாங்கள் ஒரு 10 cc சிரிஞ்ச் எடுத்து பாவிச்சு இதில் இருந்து கல்குலேஷன் எடுக்கலாம், அமௌண்ட் எடுக்கலாம். இந்த யூரின் அவுட்புட் வந்து 0.5 ml per kg per hour-ஐ விட குறையாமலுக்கு பார்த்துக்கொள்ள வேண்டும். இது ஒரு ஹவர்ஸுக்குரியது. இது நாங்கள் 3 hours கொடுக்க நாங்கள் மதர்ஸ் எடுத்தார. இதில் அவுட்புட் வந்து மொத்த டோட்டல் யூரின் அவுட்புட்டையும் பாடி வெயிட்ல இருந்து எத்தனை ஹவர்ஸ் 3 hours 3 hours 4 hours மேக்ஸிமம் கொடுக்கலாம், அதுக்கு மேலே இல்லை. மதர்ஸ்க்கு ஸ்ட்ரிக்டாக சொல்லலும் பாடி வெயிட்டோடு நாங்கள் பெருக்கி வார இதை நாங்கள் 1 ml per kg 0.5 இல்லை 0.1 ஏதோ நாங்கள் 3 hours வர வேணும். ஆனால் 0.5 ml விட குறையாமல் பார்த்துக்கொள்ள வேணும். சேம் டைம் டயப்பர் யூஸ் பண்ணுற பிள்ளைகளாக இருந்தாங்கன்னு சொன்னால் அவங்களோட டயப்பர்ஸை நாங்கள் 3 hours நார்மல் டயப்பரில் பாவிச்ச டயப்பரை இருந்து நாங்கள் லெஸ் பண்ணி அதை பாடி வெயிட் எத்தனை ஹவர்ஸ் அந்த டயப்பர் மதர் யூஸ் பண்ணாங்கன்னு கேட்டு அந்த டயப்பரை இதால் நாங்கள் பிரிக்க வேணும். பிரிச்சதுக்கு பிறகு அவங்களோட டயப்பர் யூஸ் பண்ணுற பிள்ளைகளுக்குரிய அவுட்புட்டை நாங்கள் பார்க்கலும். இதில் நாங்கள் மெயின்டைன்ஸ் ப்ரிப்பேர் பண்ணுறது ஏற்கனவே அஷத் சார் இதை பற்றி பேசியிருந்தாங்க. மெயின்டைன்ஸ் வந்துட்டு எவ்ரி 1st hour முதல் 10 kg 100 ml per kg படி நாங்கள் ஃப்ளீட் மெயின்டைன்ஸ் ஃப்ளீட்டை ப்ரிப்பேர் பண்ணோம். அடுத்த 10 kg 50 ml மீதி வார பேலன்ஸுக்கு நாங்கள் 20 ml அஷத் சார் ஏழையாக சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க. இந்த மாதிரி தான் நாங்கள் மெயின்டைன் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணுவோம். கூடுதலாக சின்ன ஆட்கள் வந்துட்டு நைட்டில் ஓவர் நைட் வந்துட்டு எனி டைம் ஃப்ளீட் எடுக்கலைன்னு சொன்னால் நாங்கள் டாக்டர்ஸ் ஓடர்ஸோட ஹாஃப் மெயின்டைன் நைட்டில் அவங்களுக்கு 12 hours ஃப்ளீட் போட இயலும். ஹாஃப் மெயின்டைன் எங்களுக்கு ஃப்ளீட் மிஸ் ஆகாமல் பார்க்கறது இதில் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இதில் ஃபுல் பிளட் கவுண்ட் வந்து டெய்லி 150,000 mm³ விட ட்ராப்பிங் பிளட்லெட் இருக்கும்னு சொன்னால் டாக்டர்ஸ் சார்னு சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க 2x டெய்லி கவுண்ட் நாங்கள் செக் பண்ண வேணும். இதில் பிசிவி வந்துட்டு டாக்டர்ஸ் ஓடர்ஸோட நாங்கள் 1 or 2x பார்ப்போம். பேஸ்லைன் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் டைம் நாங்கள் கவுண்டில் எந்த பேஸ்லைனுக்கு நாங்கள் பிசி பார்க்குறோமோ அதை நாங்கள் நார்மல் பேஸ்லைன்ஸுக்கு எடுப்போம். நார்மலி 35-37 உள்ளுக்கு எடுப்போம். என்டையர் இந்த கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்க்கு முடிக்குது. நாங்கள் பிசி வந்து ஓடல. இதுதான் கெப்பிலரி டியூப். நாங்கள் பிளட் கலெக்ஷன் இந்த மாதிரி செய்கிறது கெப்பிலரி டியூப்ல. கெப்லர் டியூப்ல எடுத்து கிளே பண்ணிட்டு எங்களோட பிசிவி மெஷினில் இந்த டியூப் வச்சுட்டு நாங்கள் ஒரு 5 minutes ரன் ஆகும். அதுக்கப்புறம் எங்களுக்கு இந்த சீரம் பிளட் வந்துட்டு செப்பரேட் ஆகிடும். செப்பரேட் ஆனது பிறகு இந்த ட்ரே வந்துட்டு மெஷர்மெண்ட் போட்டிருக்கிறாங்க. அதில் நாங்கள் கிளே பண்ணின பாயிண்ட் வந்துட்டு எங்களோட நோட் பாயிண்ட் ஆக்கி சீரம் வந்து எண்ட்ல இருக்கிற பாயிண்ட் 100ல் நாங்கள் வச்சோம்னு சொன்னால் சீரமும் பிளட்டும் வந்து எந்த இடத்துல எங்களுக்கு செப்பரேட் ஆகுதோ அந்த இடத்த நாங்கள் பிசிவி லைனை பார்க்குறோம். இதை எங்களுக்கு ஆரம்ப வரக்குள்ளேயே ஓடுக்குள்ளே செய்து பார்த்து விடுவோம். அதில் இருந்த மாதிரிக்கு ஃபெப்ரைல் ஃபேஸில் வந்துட்டு பிசிவி நாங்கள் பீடியாக பார்ப்போம். இல்லாட்டி 4 hourly அடுத்த மாதிரி பார்க்குறது. கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸில் கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ் வந்து என்டரிங் பாயிண்ட் முக்கியம் எங்களுக்கு. இதில் வந்து பிளட்டிலஸ் வந்து 100,000 mm³ விட குறைவாக ஆக அந்த எந்த பாயிண்டில் வருகிறதோ அதை நாங்கள் என்டரிங் பாயிண்ட்டாக எடுக்கிறோம். நார்மலி நாங்கள் டெம்பரேச்சர் சார்ட்டில் பார்த்த மாதிரி அது 3 ஆகவும் இருக்கலாம், 4 இருக்கலாம், சில வேலை அரிதா 7 வரையிலும் எவ்வளத்தில் ரெபிட் ட்ரோப் ஆஃப் டெம்பரேச்சர் இருக்கிறதோ நாங்க அந்த இடத்துல அலர்ட் ஆகணும் கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸுக்கு. அதே நேரம் எங்களோட பிசிவிம் வந்து 35-37 நார்மல்ல இருந்து 20% இன்க்ரீஸ் ஆஃப் ஃபுளுயிட் லீக்கேஜ்னு சொன்னா அந்த இடத்துல நாங்க அலர்ட் ஆக வேணும், எங்களோட கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்க்கு என்டர் ஆகணும்னு சொல்லி. இந்த இடத்துல வந்து நார்மலா டெங்கு ஃபீவரும் வைரல் ஃபீவர் வந்து எங்களுக்கு ஃபீவர் வந்து குறைஞ்சிட்டு வரக்குள்ள பேஷண்டோட நார்மல் ஜென்ரல் கண்டிஷன்ல வந்து ஒரு இம்ப்ரூவ்மெண்ட் இருக்கு. ஆனா எங்களோட டெங்கு ஹெமரேஜ் ஃபீவர்ல வந்து அந்த ஃபீவர் சடனா ரெபீட் இதயக்குள்ள நார்மல் ஜென்ரலான கண்டிஷன் இருக்காது, அங்கக்குள்ள வந்து வேர்ஸ் ஆக தொடங்கும். ஸோ இந்த இடத்துல நாங்கள் அலர்ட்டாக இருக்க வேணும். எங்களுக்கு கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்ல டியூரேஷன் வந்து 48 hours. இதுல முக்கியம் வந்து எங்களோட கீ ஃபேக்டர்னு சொல்றது வந்து எப்ப நாங்க கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ் என்டரிங் பாயிண்ட்ல ஆரம்பிக்கிறோமோ அதுல இருந்து 48 hoursல முடியிற அந்த கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ் 48 hoursம் எங்களுக்கு ஃப்ளூயிட் தெரபி கொடுக்கறதுக்கு ஒரு கைடா இருக்கும். டெங்கு ஹெமரேஜ் ஃபீவர்ல கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ் மானிட்டரிங் கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்ல நாங்க இங்க வந்து டிஃபரென்ஷியான சார்ட் அப்சர்வேஷன் மானிட்டரிங் சார்ட் யூஸ் பண்றோம் ஏஜ் வைஸா. இதுல மானிட்டரிங் சார்ட் 1 வந்து கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்ல வந்து ஸ்டேபிளா இருக்கிற குழந்தைகளுக்கு சில்ட்ரன்ஸ்க்கு நாங்க மானிட்டரிங் சார்ட் 1 இது அவர்லி சார்டா இருக்கும். இந்த சார்ட் நாங்க நார்மலா வார்டில் ஏஜுக்கு டிஃபரன்ஷியேட் பண்ணி பாவிக்கிறது. நார்மலா லெஸ் தென் 1 இயர் பேபிஸ் நாங்க அலர்ட் ஹார்ட் ரேட் வந்து 160 லைன் வச்சிருக்கோம். அதே நேரம் 1 to 2 இயர்ஸ்க்கு லெஸ் ஹார்ட் ரேட் அலர்ட் வந்து 150, 2 to 5 இயர்ஸ் 1 to 140 ஹார்ட் ரேட், நார்மலா 5 to 12 இயர்ஸ்க்கு 120. இது எங்களோட வார்டில் ஏஜை டிஃபரெண்ட் பண்ணி வச்சிருக்கிறோம். இதுல மெயினா ஐடியல் பாடி வெயிட் அசோசியல் சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க, ஐடியல் பாடி வெயிட் எப்படி கல்குலேஷன் பண்ண வேணும் என்று அந்த ஐடியல் பாடி வெயிட்டும் நாங்கள் எடுக்க வேணும். எங்களோட டே ஆஃப் ஃபீவரையும் இதில் நோட் பண்ணி விடுவோம். வந்த உடனே ஃபெப்ரவரி ஃபேஸ்ல நாங்கள் எந்த பாயிண்ட்ல பேஸ்லைன் பிசி பார்க்குறோமோ அதை மென்ஷன் பண்ண வேணும். அதே நேரம் கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ் எக்ஸிட் டைம் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட், இதில் என்ட்ரி டைம் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். அது நாங்கள் எந்த டைம் கொடுக்குறோம் என்ட்ரி அதுல இருந்து 48 hoursஆல எங்களோட கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்ல எக்ஸிட் டைம் கொடுக்க வேணும். இந்த சார்ட் பேலன்ஸ் இது எங்களோட அவுட்புட் ஃபுளீட் இன்டேக் சார்ட். இது இதுல நாங்கள் அவுட்புட் வந்து 0.5 ml/kg தான் மெயின். இதுல இருந்து எங்களுக்கு 0.5 ml/kg விட எங்களோட அவுட்புட் குறைஞ்சிட்டு போகுதுன்னு சொன்னாலோ இல்ல 0.5 to 1 ml/kg 1 ml அப்பானதுன்னு சொன்னாலோ இமீடியட்டா நாங்க டாக்டர்ஸுக்கு இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ண வேணும். என்னண்டா எங்களோட 0.5 ml/kg விட அவுட்புட் குறையுதுன்னு சொன்னா நாங்க கொடுக்குற புளியட்டானது பிள்ளைக்கு போதாத அளவுக்கு இருக்கும் இல்லையா. 1 ml விட ஃபுளீட் கூடுதுன்னு சொன்னா நாங்க கொடுக்குற ஃபுளீட் வந்து 2 high இருக்கும். இப்ப நாங்க இமீடியட்டா ஃபுளீட்டை கரெக்ஷன் பண்றதுக்கு இந்த யூரின் அவுட்புட் வச்சு நாங்க சில ஃபுளீட் சார்ட் இருக்குது 1 ml/kg/hour 2 ml/kg/hour சொல்லி இந்த இடத்துல நாங்க ஃபுளீட்டை எங்களால அட்ஜஸ்ட் பண்ணிடணும். இதுல ஓரல் டார்கெட் கொடுக்கறதா இருந்தா மாதிர ஓரல் டார்கெட் கொடுக்க இயலும், அதோட ஐ ஃபுளீட்டும் வரும். இந்த கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்ல நாங்க குவாட்டா ஃபுளீட் கால்குலேட் பண்ண வேணும். குவாட்டா ஃபுளீட் நார்மலா மெயின்டைன்ஸ் நாங்கள் கல்குலேட் பண்றதோட எங்களோட 5% பாடி வெயிட்ல இருந்து எங்களோட வெயிட்டை உள்ளட அந்த வெயிட்டை மல்டிபிள் பண்ண வேணும். இதுல இருந்து மெயின்டைன்ஸும் 5% பாடி வெயிட்டும் சேர்ந்து எங்களுக்கு M+5 டோட்டல் ஃபுளீட் கோட்டா வரும். இந்த டோட்டல் ஃபுளீட் கோட்டா நாங்கள் வந்து ஸ்டார்ட் பண்றதுல இருந்து எந்த ஃபுளீட் கொடுத்தாலும் இந்த 48 hours உள்ளுக்கும் எங்களோட டோட்டல் ஃபுளீட் கோட்டாக்குள்ள அடங்கக்கூடிய மாதிரி இருக்க வேணும். நாங்க எந்த ஃபுளீட் கொடுக்கக்குள்ள அந்த ஃபுளீட்டு இந்த டோட்டல் ஃபுளீட் கோட்டாட லாஸ்ட் லைன் கேட்கிற கோட்டா லெஃப்ட் என்ற குளத்துல லெஃப்ட் பண்ணி கொண்டு வர வேணும் வந்து 48 hours. நாங்க கல்குலேட் பண்ண 48 hours கோட்டா மட்டுமே எங்களுக்கு முடிகிற டைம்ல பினிஷ் ஆயிருக்கு. இதை விட எங்களுக்கு கூடவும் கூடாது குறையவும் கூடாது இந்த கோட்டா ஃபுளீட். இது இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இதுல நாங்க மானிட்டர் இன்க்ளூட் பண்ணக்குள்ள இதுல கூடுதலா நாங்க டோட்டல் ஃபுளீட் டெக்னீஷியன்ல ஓரலும் ஐவியும் எடுக்கிறோம். இதுல கம்ப்ளீட்டா ஓரல் கிரிட்டிக்கல் ஃபேஸ்ல பிள்ளைகள் ஓரல் ஃபுளீட்டை எடுக்காம அவாய்ட் பண்ணா நாங்க ஃபுல் ஐவிக்கு மாத்தி விட்டுருவோம். ஃபுல் ஐவி டாக்டர்ஸ் ஆர்டர்ஸ் படி 2 ml/1.5 ml/kg தொடக்கம் 3 ml/kg போகும். இதுல பீக் பாயிண்ட் வரக்குள்ள சொன்ன மாதிரி 750 kg மோதன் எல்லாருக்கும் வராது. அப்படி வரக்குள்ள ஷாக் அந்த பீக் பாயிண்ட் எங்களுக்கு வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இதுலதான் எங்களுக்கு ஷாக் வர இருக்கு, ஷாக் ஓ லீக்கேஜ். இது வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் நாங்க ஒப்சர்வ் பண்றதுக்கு. இதுக்கு நாங்க மெஷர் பண்ற என்னன்னு சொன்னா HCTPC மெஷர்மெண்ட் 4 to 6 அவர்லி நான் ஷாக் பேஷண்ட்ல பார்ப்போம், 1 to 2 அவர்லி இன் ஷாக்ல பார்ப்போம். எங்களுக்கு பீக் பாயிண்ட் ஷாக் அப்படி வர்ற டைமோ இல்ல லீக்கேஜ் வர்ற டைமோ எங்கட அவர்லி மானிட்டரிங்க நாங்க குவார்ட் அவர்லி மானிட்டரிங்க நாங்க சேஞ்ச் பண்ணி விட்டுருவோம். குவார்ட் அவர்லி மானிட்டரிங் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இந்த டைம் எங்களுக்கு யூரின் அவுட்புட் எல்லாம் மெஷர் பண்றது கஷ்டம்னு சொன்னா நாங்க கத்திட்ரைஸ் பண்ணியலும் டாக்டர்ஸ் ஆர்டர்ஸோட கத்திட்ரைஸிங் போது நாங்க யூரினோமீட்டர் யூஸ் பண்ணியலும். யூரினோமீட்டர் மூலமா நாங்க யூரின் அவுட்புட் 50 minutes எங்களால ஒப்சர்வ் பண்ணியலும் எங்களோட ஃபுளியிட் யூரின் அவுட்புட். இதுல நாங்க ஃபுளியிட் அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட்ல எங்களுக்கு பல்ஸ் ரேட் பிபி ரெஸ்பிரேட்டர் சிஆர்எஃப்டியோட பிசி யூரின் அவுட்புட்டை வச்சு எங்களோட ஐவி ஃபுளியிட்டை அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட் பண்ணியலும். நாங்கள் நார்மலா ஏரியா அப்சர்வேஷன் சார்ட்ல சொன்ன மாதிரி எங்களோட நார்மல் ரேஞ்ச் 0.5 to 1 ml/kg பர் அவர் படி இருக்கும் சொன்னா நாங்க நார்மலா ஃபுளியிட்ல போய் கொண்டிருக்கிறோம், இன்ஃபியூஷன் கொடுத்து கொண்டிருக்கிறோம் என்று எடுக்கலும். இதே இது 1 ml கூடினா எங்களோட இன்ஃபியூஷன் ரேட் வந்துட்டு ரொம்ப கூடுதலா போகுது. ஸோ நாங்க இமீடியட்டா டாக்டருக்கு இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ண வேணும். 0.5 ml விட குறையுதுன்னு சொன்னா நாங்க எடுக்கிற ஃபுளியிட் வந்துட்டு ரொம்ப குறைவா இருக்குது, அதே நாங்க இமீடியட்டா கூற வேணும். இதுல நாங்க ஷாக்கு ஏர்லி டிடெக்ஷன் ஷாக் இருக்குது. ஏர்லி டிடெக்ஷன் ஆஃப் ஷாக்ஸ் சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க. அதுல சில சிம்டம்ஸ் ஸ்வெட்டிங், அப்டோமினல் பெயின், ரெஸ்ட்லெஸ்னஸ், ஆல்டர்ட் கான்சியஸ் லெவல் இருக்கு. இதை நாங்க ஒப்சர்வ் பண்ணி மானிட்டர் பண்ணக்குள்ள உடனடியா நாங்க டாக்டர் இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ணணும். ஏன்னா ப்ரொலாங் ஷாக் வந்து ஆஃப்டர் 4 hours தாண்டி போனா டெத்து டிஐசி வர எல்லாம் சான்ஸ் இருக்கு. இதனால நாங்க இமீடியட்டா டாக்டர்ஸுக்கு இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ண வேணும். சேம் டைம் இதுல சைன்ஸ் வந்து கால் எக்ஸ்ட்ரீமைட்டிஸ், ப்ரலாங் கேபிலரி ரீஃபில் டைம், நாங்க மோர் தென் 2 seconds விட இருக்கும்னு சொன்னாலோ, அண்ட் எக்ஸ்பிளைன் டெக்கிகார்டியா, இன்க்ரீசிங் டயஸ்டாலிக் ப்ரெஷர், நரோயிங் ஆஃப் பல்ஸ் ப்ரெஷர் இவ்வளவும் எங்களுக்கு இருக்கும்னு சொன்னா உடனே நாங்க சொல்லணும். இதுல பல்ஸ் ப்ரெஷர் வந்துட்டு நாங்க சிஸ்டோலிக்ல இருந்து டயஸ்டோலிக்க மைனஸ் பண்ணி நாங்க பல்ஸ் ப்ரெஷரை காணையிலும். இந்த மாதிரியான சிம்டம் இருந்தா நாங்க இமீடியட்டா டாக்டர்ஸுக்கு இன்ஃபார்ம் பண்ண வேணும். அந்த பாயிண்ட்ல நாங்க ஃபுளீட் கொடுக்கறதுக்கு, ஃபுளீட் போலஸ் கொடுக்கறதுக்கு நாங்க எங்களை தயார்படுத்திக் கொள்ள வேணும். ஃபுளீட் போலஸ ரெடி பண்ணி வச்சுக்கொள்ள வேணும். இதுல எவ்வளவு நாங்க ஃபுளீட் கொடுத்தும், போதுமான ஃபுளீட் தெரப்பியை கொடுத்தும் எங்களுக்கு எந்த இம்ப்ரூவ்மெண்ட்டும் இல்லைன்னு சொல்லி சொன்னா நாங்க இமீடியட்டா கன்சிடர் பண்ண வேணும் ABCS. ஏ எசிடோசிஸ், பி ப்ளீடிங், சி கால்சியம், எஸ் சுகர். இந்த ஏபிசிஎஸ் பத்தி நல்ல விளக்கம் அஷர் சார் அவங்க தந்தாங்க, அதோட சுந்தரேஷன் சார் அவர்கள் தந்தாங்க. அவங்களோட ஆர்டர்ஸ் நாங்க கேரி அவுட் பண்ணி இந்த எசிடோசிஸ் ப்ளீடிங் கால்சியம் சுகருக்கு அவங்களோட ஆர்டர்ஸ் டாக்டர்ஸ் ஆர்டர்ஸோட கேரி அவுட் பண்ணி நாங்க இமீடியட்டா கொடுக்கலாம். இதுல மெயின் எங்களுக்கு சார் சொன்ன மாதிரி 2 கெனூலா ரொம்ப முக்கியம். இதுல நாங்க 1 கெனூலா வந்து யூஸ் பண்றது பிளட் ட்ரோவிங்கா, பிளட் ட்ரோவிங் கெனூலான்னு சொல்லி நாங்க போட்டு விடுவோம். பிளட் ட்ரோவிங் கெனூலாவில் எனி டைம் சின்ன ஆட்களுக்கு பெரிய ஆட்கள் மாதிரி குத்தி எடுக்க இயலாது, அதனால பிளட் ட்ரோவிங் கழிவுல எங்களுக்கு இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். அதுலேருந்து நாங்க எங்களுக்கு தேவையான நேரத்துக்கு நாங்க பிளட் கலெக்ஷன் எடுத்துக்கொள்ளலும். அடுத்த கெனூலா வந்து நாங்க ஐ ஃபுளீட்டுக்காகவோ வேற ஏதாவது போலஸ் கொடுக்கறதுக்காகவோ நாங்க அதை யூஸ் பண்ணுவோம். சம்டைம்ஸ் சர்ஸ் அந்த மாதிரி கேனுல அவுட் ஆனாலும் நாங்க இமீடியட்டா பிளட் ட்ரோயிங் கேனுலாவை யூஸ் பண்ணியலும் எங்களுக்கு இந்த இடத்துல. இதுல கன்வர்சன் ஃபேஸ், ரிகவரி ஃபேஸ் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். இதுல நாங்க ஒப்சர்வ் பண்ண வேண்டியது என்னன்னா எங்களுக்கு மதர்ஸ் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட். மதர்ஸ் வந்து சில சிம்டம்ஸ் பார்த்த உடனே பயப்படுவாங்க. நாங்க ஆல்ரெடி நாங்க அவங்களுக்கு இந்த ரிகவரி ஃபேஸ் பத்தி நாங்க கொடுத்துட வேணும். இதுல மெயின் வந்து மதர்ஸுக்கு அந்த ஒயிட் ரெட் பேக்ரவுண்ட்ல வர ஒயிட் பேச்சஸ் பத்தி சார் சொல்லியிருந்தாங்க, அதுல பற்றி நாங்க விளக்கத்தை சரியா கொடுக்க வேணும். இம்ப்ரூவ் ஹெப்படைட்டி, ஜெனரலைஸ் இச்சிங் ஒன்று இருக்கும். இதெல்லாம் வந்து அவங்களோட ரிகவரிக்குரிய நல்ல ஒரு சைன். ஹிமோடைனமிக் ஸ்டெபிலிட்டி, பிரடிகார்டியா, டயூரெசிஸ், இன்க்ரீஸ் டோட்டல் கவுண்ட் இருக்கும். இந்த டைம்ல மதர்ஸ் நாங்க கூட அட்வைஸ் பண்ண வேணும், சின்னவங்கன்றதுனால கூடுதலா ஓடி ஆடி திரிவாங்க, அதனால அவங்கள கூட பெட் ரெஸ்ட்ல வைக்க வேணும். இந்த அவங்களோட பிளேட்லெட் வந்துட்டு லோ பாயிண்ட்க்கு போயிட்டு தான் அது மேலுக்கு வர வேண்டியிருக்கும். அதனால நாங்க அவங்கள பெட் ரெஸ்ட் வச்சிருக்க வேணும். எங்க சரி அவங்க விழுந்து தலையில அடிபட்டாலோ பிளீடிங் வர்றதுக்கு சான்ஸ் கூட. அதே நேரம் அவங்க ஸ்கூல் இதுவளுக்கு அனுப்பாமலுக்கு ஒரு 1 week சரி ரெஸ்ட் எடுக்க சொல்ல வேணும் நாங்க பேரண்ட்ஸுக்கு. அதே நேரத்துல அவங்க இப்ப டிஸ்சார்ஜ் ஆகி போறதா இருந்தாலும் அவங்களுக்கு ஒரு வைரல் போஸ்ட் வைரல்ல வர ஒரு ட்ரோசினஸ் ஒன்று இருக்கும். இதை பத்தி நாங்க அவங்களுக்கு விளக்கம் சொல்ல வேணும். போஸ்ட் வைரல் வர ட்ரோசினஸ் பத்தி மதர்ஸ் அதால பயப்படையிலும் கூடுதலா அவங்கள போதுமான அளவுக்கு ஃபுளுயிட்டேக்க கூட்ட சொல்ல வேணும். ரிகவரி பேஸ் வந்தது பிறகு இன்அடிக்குவேட் ஃபுளுயிட் அவங்கள எடுக்க சொல்ல வேணும். சிலவேளை பாடி பெயின்ஸ் இருக்கும்னு சொல்லிச்சோம்னா அந்த நேரம் நாங்கள் பொட்டாசியம் சேர்ந்த கிங் கோகோனட் அதுவல கொஞ்சம் அவாய்ட் பண்ண சொல்லி சொல்லும் டாக்டர்ஸ் அட்வைஸ் அவங்களுக்கு கொடுக்க வேணும். நாங்கள் இதில் எங்களுக்கு மெயின் வந்து இந்த சார்டுகளை நாங்கள் போர்டில் மெயினாக ஒப்சர்வ் பண்ண வேணும். சார்டில் இதில் நாங்கள் பல்ஸ் ப்ரெஷர் வந்து எப்போவும் லெஸ் தென் 20 விட குறைய வரப்போகக்குள்ளே இம்மீடியட்டாக நாங்கள் டாக்டர்ஸுக்கு சொல்லிட வேணும். ஒரு 3 எபிசோடில் பார்க்குற நேரத்துக்கு தேங்க்யூ.
நன்றி. மிகவும் அழகாகவும் தெளிவான முறையில வைத்தியசாலைகளில் எப்படி நாங்கள் மானிட்டர் பண்றது சம்பந்தமாக தெளிவுபடுத்தியிருந்தீர்கள். உண்மையில் இந்த டெங்கு நோயை கட்டுப்படுத்துகின்ற இந்த விடயத்துல வந்து கள ரீதியாக ப்ரிவென்டிவ் மெசேஜ் கண்டினியூ பண்ணப்படுற அதே சமயத்துல வந்து வைத்தியசாலைகள் அனுமதிக்கப்படுற நோயாளர்கள மேனேஜ் பண்ற அதுவும் சம நிலையில ரெண்டும் ஒரே நேரத்துல நடக்கவும் அதுலேயும் முக்கியமாக ஹாஸ்பிட்டல்ல பேஷண்ட்ஸ் அட்மிட் பண்ணப்பட்ட பிறகு மேனேஜ்மெண்ட் பார்ட்ல வந்து மானிட்டரிங் பார்ட் மிக முக்கியமானது. அந்த விஷயத்துல வந்து நர்சிங் ஆபீசர்ஸ் அவங்களோட அந்த பங்களிப்பு மிகவும் பாராட்டத்தக்க ஒரு விடயம். அவை அந்த மானிட்டரிங் பார்ட் சம்பந்தமாகத்தான் இப்ப ரிஸ்மியா மிஸ் தெளிவுபடுத்தியிருந்தாங்க. இதுல ஏதாவது சந்தேகங்கள் அல்லது ஏதாவது தெளிவுகள் புறக்கொண்டமாக இருந்தால் உங்களுக்குரிய கேள்விகளை நீங்க இப்போது கேட்டுக்கொள்ளலாம். கேள்விகள் நினைக்கின்றேன். நாவே மீண்டும் ஒரு தடவை இந்த மானிட்டரிங் பார்ட் விடயங்களை தெளிவுபடுத்திய மேகா ரிஸ்மியா மிஸுக்கு நன்றி சொல்லிக்கொண்டு இதனை முடித்து வைப்பதற்காக எங்களுடைய கன்சல்டன்ட்
Thank you so much for all of you. I think we have come to the end of a very fruitful session. We hope and expect that you will follow these instructions when managing the patients at your settings. And if you have any questions not raised at this moment, but we'll find that you need to understand more, so you can contact the relevant consultants. I think they already gave you the contact details, and please get verified if there are any things that you need more clarification. So once again, I want to officially announce that we are going to end our session on clinical management of dengue patients in Eastern Province, conducted together by National Dengue Control Unit, Ministry of Health, Sri Lanka, and also the Eastern Provincial Director of Health Services. Once again, I would like to thank you so much for Dr. K.T. Sundaresan, Consultant Physician, Teaching Hospital Batiklo, and Dr. Arshad Ahmed, Consultant Pediatrician, Base Hospital, Tintawur, and also Ms. A.L. Rizmi, Nursing Officer, Pediatric Ward in Ashraf Memorial Hospital. Thank you so much for all the speakers and also the participants for your contribution and participation. Thank you.
Thank you.